back deep to return this kickoff for the Horns. Underway in Austin. Sanders. 25. Cut back. Put it on the ground. Loose ball. The second juggle, the Horns might have pounced on it.
Good call, Brent. It looked like Kansas State had a chance. In fact, it was the kicker who had a chance to jump on top of it. Cantelli, maybe that's why he's the kicker, unable to secure the football and gave Texas a chance to get back and have a shot at it. It's a great effort because it looked like he might get loose. A great effort to actually bring him down. The ball's loose. There's Cantelli, the kicker. He's right there. He's got the recovery. Ball slips through his arms, and Texas catches a break here early.
Stays in as one of the wideouts. Ash is your quarterback, and Jonathan Gray, 32, is your running back. Jeff Swain is that H-back back there, and after they straighten out the confusion, there's a penalty flag, and as the final seconds were ticking off, it's a delay of game, Herbie, to start here tonight.
Yeah, and that's the last thing that Mac Brown said. Let's go. Now, remember, he's got a quarterback in David Ash who sat out last week because of the concussion after the BYU game, and, you know, they have almost a near fumble. They come out for their first snap, and they have a delay of game. That's not the way Mac Brown envisioned this game starting.
So now it's first and 15, and Ash on the roll, incomplete, and that route was jumped by the defensive back.
Wow, there's some pregame jitters here. You know, this is a conference game for both of these teams, and a game where David Ash wants to get off to a good start. Mid-drop point, that's exactly what he said. Let's get him off to a good start.
So Gray, the ball carrier on second and 15. You may note that Texas trying to run tempo for Major Applewhite, who's upstairs calling plays. Barnett with the stop. And now it is a tough third down here.
Yeah, and part of the reason they like to go tempo, not only the obvious reasons to try to get the defense on their heels, but they feel that David Ash seems to relax and perform better in this up-tempo style.
So on third and 10, Ash with time could not find the open receiver, has to throw it away, and the Horns are first to punt on their first possession of the night.
And keep in mind, Mike Davis, one of their best receivers, and Dante Johnson, their other top receiver, are out for this football game, so they're trying to do it with some others. Got good pressure, contained him, and Ash had nobody open. All he could do was just throw the football away.
Tyler Lockett and Tremaine Thompson are back deep, and both are very, very dangerous for the Wildcats. Anthony Farrah, the transfer for Penn State, will punt it away. Special teams always good under Coach Snyder. Back to the 15-yard line, Thompson with a fair catch. And that's where the Wildcats will put it in play here with their first series of the game. Now, the one thing, Herbie, that the coaches of the Longhorns are going to have to keep an eye on that far sideline is which quarterback comes out. Now, Jake Waters has been listed as a starter. Here comes the young man. He, of course, was the junior college quarterback of the year last year.
That's right. And Daniel Sams, the backup, will also get some reps tonight. We said in the open, Waters is more the passer, but can run. And Sams is more the runner and also has the ability to throw.
Coach Snyder always liked to script the first few plays, so let's see what they come up with. And Waters complete on a flanker screen. He puts it in Tyler Lockett's hands for a 9-yard gain.
Something to keep in mind, this Texas defense, it's been talked about for the last couple weeks, they have struggled in defending the run, in particular the option attack. One thing they've worked on all week is defending the run. And in doing that, you got to wonder how much Bill Snyder may try to attack through the air to try to offset that, because he knows that Texas has spent so much time trying to fix that problem.
John Hubert just to the right of Waters. B.J. Finney, a good junior, is the center now as Waters goes to the line to change. And now 5 seconds remaining. Got to get that off, and he does. Waters to carry, option look. Texas tries to jam it. Penalty flag comes down, thrown by the linesman.
Yeah, it looked like a face mask there by Texas.
So Greg Robinson, who was brought out of retirement to coach the defense.
Personal foul, face mask, defense number two. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. First down.
This is Thompson who grabs his face mask, one of the safeties.
And you can see Hubert was confused on which way to go. Kansas State might have picked up the first down, but clearly grabs the face mask and even a horse collar there.
Yeah, I thought it was more of a horse collar than a face mask. I thought he grabbed the pads
around
there. So at any rate, it is first down and 10. Glenn Gronkowski, familiar football name, lead blocker for Waters. And here comes that running game that you protected, Herbie, because Coach Snyder wants to find out what adjustments has Robinson made on the near sideline. What changes? Now, there's a coach that's so thorough. Robinson was a head coach at Syracuse, defensive coordinator at Michigan his last two stops. Bill Snyder and his staff went and got tapes of both Syracuse and Michigan just to see what kind of different looks they could expect here tonight. Most prepared coach I've ever been around.
No doubt about it.
Is Bill Snyder.
Yep.
Second down and 7.
Got man-free coverage on the outside.
And Waters is going to put it up. A lot of time. Fires far side, incomplete. Pretty good coverage.
Very good coverage. You're never going to think about Texas not having athletic ability. They feel pretty confident in their ability to cover these Kansas State wide receivers. Waters is going to have to make some decisions and make them quick, because you can see the windows are going to be tight and there's not a lot of space there. To me, Kansas State, it's all about trying to avoid third and long, kind of controlling the clock and controlling the down and distance.
Well, here's your third and 7. Let's see what Coach Robinson whistles up now. Linebacker is trying to listen in. Waters, the stunt, in trouble. Good call by Robinson on the Texas side. Got it done. Malcolm Brown, big number 90, was blowing that up.
They brought a blitz this time, and it is a very good call because Jordan Hicks has great speed. You see him at the top, the outside linebacker. They also brought the nickelback Diggs, and I think it caught Waters off guard. Really didn't anticipate that kind of pressure. They brought one more than Kansas State could handle. There's nothing Waters could do there.
Mark Krause to punt it, and a familiar name, Shipley, but this Jackson Shipley back deep for the Horns. He almost got there. Shipley from the 15. Kept the handle on it and picked up a yard on that return. So we'll take a break. Texas, Kansas State, Big 12 opener here in Austin. Quarterback David Ash, number 14, is a junior from Belton, Texas. And Herbie, one of my favorite little anecdotes about him is, like you and me and the folks watching, yeah, he had a television set at home, but no one ever watched it. He was not a child of television.
No, he was not. He loved Colt McCoy, though, and loved to have a chance to try to follow in his footsteps and see if he could get Texas going. And tonight, he's feeling the pressure. He's got to settle in here. It's important, I think, and I think you would agree, that they need to get off to a good start, see what they do here on this second series.
Play action, take it away, and throw for 9 yards. And Swain, H-back, tight end look from Chico, California, makes the grab.
There's the tempo again. Good job of spreading Kansas State out, trying to isolate those linebackers in space. Trying to see if you can have a tight end or one of your slot receivers make a play.
So this is a hurry up and wait. You could see them look over to the sideline after they move to the line of scrimmage. And the offensive staff trying to adjust to the look. And that time, Ash on a nice play fake. I mean, you could see how well he faked the ball that time, forcing Blake Slaughter to tackle the quarterback, but it's a first down.
It's 6'3", 220. He is a tremendous athlete. He's, again, one of these dual-threat guys. With the spread look, they're looking to see what the defense is trying to do against these formations.
Again, it's play action. Ash going to have to throw this out of bounds, and it'll be second down and 10. I believe Ash now is 0-for-3, and there was plenty of pressure coming. Ryan Mueller, number 44, was rolling in for the Wildcats.
It's another one of these offenses that spreads the defense out, and they'll look at the players that are over the slot receivers, just showing Vince Young there on the scoreboard.
Let me correct that. He's 1-of-4, obviously. He threw
a
big pass. Now he's 2-of-5 as he snaps this one off to Kendall Sanders. And the stop by Roberts.
Trying to get him into rhythm, coming off an off week where he didn't get a play against Ole Miss. So a lot of quick throws, A lot of simple reads. Just get the ball and get the ball out of his hands. This is third down in an obvious passing situation. But when Kansas State has to line up and deal with these three receivers, how they deal with this man is the key. If you keep a guy in close to the line of scrimmage, that's when they'll try to throw.
Nash fires for the first down, and that's Shipley. Jackson Shipley, Jordan's little brother. And there are some who believe that he's going to become a better receiver than Jordan, and he was a good man.
Well, the great thing about Shipley is he has a lot of the same attributes as his brother.
Now it's first down and 10. Offensive line doing a good job. Ash couldn't find a receiver, takes it around, and then fires around to Sanders was the target. And Mueller shaken up on the play for the Wildcats. He's down.
And he's their best defensive lineman. You know, this defense lost 9 starters from last year. You know, we talked about Shipley. This is an example now that we have a break here. Third down and 8. Look how he knows exactly where to go. Go a yard or two beyond the first down marker. So when you come back to the football, you make the catch, you get across the line for the first down. Those are kind of the instincts that Shipley brings to the table. Mueller, a former walk-on, and such a big part of what this defense is trying to do this year.
Now we'll take a break while the young man's being tended to. No score, first quarter, Austin.
Saturday Night Football presented by Windows. Brought to you by Windows. Bud Light, it's the sure sign of a good time. Here we go. And Nissan, premier partner of the Heisman Trophy.
Darrell Royals undefeated 1963 national championship team here in Texas. Let's take a look at Herbie, how Mueller went down.
Boom. Right there, Ryan Mueller rushing the quarterback. Got hit and hit hard by Jonathan Gray. He was locked up with Kennedy Estelle, and then Gray lowered the boom on him right into his rib cage. That was a big hit.
So it'll be second down and 10. Jonathan Gray figures to get more carries tonight than he did in the second half against Ole Miss. Major Applewhite said he wants to get him more involved for the entire game than he did in that contest. Play action to him again and throw to Shipley along the sideline, and Shipley's out of bounds at the 45-yard line. Rand 11th there defensively.
Kansas State's goal every year with Bill Snyder is kind of a bend but don't break defense. Keep everything in front, swarm to the football, and losing 9 seniors from last year, really the only guy that played a lot of football was Ty Zimmerman, the free safety. So this group, as young as they are, on the road for the first time, they're just trying to prevent the big play, swarm to the football.
Ash is back now. He's going to take off. Good run. First down. Cross midfield. And he is blasted down by Kip Daly.
Kip Daly is the young man who had the 2 interceptions from last week. One for an interception. One for a touchdown, rather. It's a good job by Ash. Gets back quickly. Makes a decision to take off with it to pick up that first down.
Running tempo. Here's Gray to the 40-yard line on first down.
Now, Major Applewhite doing a very good job of mixing things up. Remember, concussion kept him out last week. That is a big hit by Kip Daly. Major mixing up the run with the pass right now with this attack.
Interesting that Jonathan Gray's body language indicates let's speed it up, and now he's saying, I'm not too sure what you want done here. Second down and 5, and Nash goes up behind the center and then retreats into the gun. Receivers are covered, bounces back a midfield on the move now, and he's going to throw it incomplete. John Harris, the junior, the intended target on that play, but it's going to bring up another third down here for the Longhorns.
Already 2 of 3 here early in this game. Mueller, good to see back in the lineup after that big hit that he took from Jonathan Gray. Remember, the mobility is causing Kansas State's defense fits with Ash, and it's been big on third down to keep plays alive.
Looking short side, and a grab, and out of bounds by Marcus Johnson.
You know, he had a knee that he injured in camp. It's a really good effort to try to get a foot down. Has possession, gets the right foot down. That is a great catch by Johnson. And how about the throw by Ash on third down?
25-yard gain into the red zone. And Gray's the ball carrier. Battles his way to the 15. Barnett with the stop.
This is the area of the field in the red zone where the game's going to be won or lost for these two teams. Kansas State's willing to give up some yardage, but they want to tighten it up here and make Texas settle for field goals. Texas needs touchdowns in this part of the field.
Second and five, and it's Gray short of the first down.
Jonathan Gray, you can see why the coaches feel that with this group of running backs, Gray, Brown, and Bergeron, Gray's really emerged and become the guy.
Give it to him. Swing outside to Daylight. Fumble recovered by Kansas State. Gray turns it over. Had the first down. Barnett comes up with the loose ball, and the Horns fumble in the red zone.
I think they'll probably take another peek at this. Barnett doing a good job of filling, but watch the right arm. I think that right arm touched and caused the ground, actually, may have caused that ball to come out. They'll probably take another peek, and I think it'll be, could be a possession staying with Texas.
A lot of folks are here from Manhattan, Kansas, over close to the play, and they're unhappy that being reviewed, but Derby, I think you're exactly right, and we'll see what instant replay decides on this play with our Big 12 officiating crew.
Again, Jonathan Graves, when he came out of high school a couple years ago, he's the number one ranked high school running back in the country. And I think he's starting to really settle in now into college level.
If they say Texas has possession, remember, it's a first down. He had the first down. It was only third and one.
That's right.
So it will be first and goal if Texas retains possession.
Remember, an area that Texas has really struggled with historically against Kansas State in the nine games that Mack Brown's gone up against them has been turnovers. They're at minus 20 against Kansas State and Bill Snyder in those nine games, and they're 2-7. So turnovers has been a big area that they've struggled and lost that margin. It's cost him a lot of victories against Bill Snyder.
Yeah, good point, Herbie, because this five-game losing streak they're in.
That's right.
Mack Brown telling us it's all been turnovers.
Mm-hmm. It's a big call for Mack Brown, considering everything that's going on the outside. They're in a great position here to get off to a good start, try to put points on the board.
David Ames is upstairs in the replay booth, and Reggie Smith is our Big 12 referee here tonight. Has to be indisputable, remember. If there's any indication it was coming out on the way down, it'll be Kansas State football. If that ball is loose in any way before arm hits.
I personally don't think it didn't look like it was loose at all until his elbow or forearm touched the ground, and then the ball came out. He didn't seem to lose possession of it at all until he touched the surface.
And the other thing that instant replay must decide is, where did that arm touch? If Texas retains possession, where is it across the 10-yard line? Because the ball is back now where it was recovered.
Yeah, right where his elbow touched, I think, right at the 8-yard line. That might be what, if they are going to reverse it, that might be part of what's taking the time here for the officiating.
Well, Jonathan Gray indicated immediately, but don't they always? But he
yeah,
was down.
Of course.
Taking a long time. This is a very, very big play when you're across the 10-yard line. Big play both ways.
He's got the call.
After further review, the ball carrier's elbow was down prior to losing the ball. It will be Texas's ball, first and goal from the 8-yard line.
So there we have it. First down and goal from the 8-yard line. Jonathan Gray breathes a sigh of relief.
But at the same time, it doesn't get away from the importance of they've got to still come up with a touchdown. It's one thing, they've controlled possession. Now they got to try to get the ball into the end zone.
You see if he looks for his buddy Shipley down here. Low snap. Picks it up. Ash is forced to scramble, and they lose a yard. It'll be second down and goal. Truman cleans it up.
That's, again, an unforced error by Texas. We've seen a few here. That's something that Ash has got to be able to avoid. He's focused on that defense, but he's got to be focused on executing.
Gray's not going to get there. Third down and long. Wow, now they're forced to throw. You would have thought on first or second, they might have chucked it.
And they lost an opportunity there on first down and put him in a little bit behind the eight ball on second down. As you say, now they're in that obvious position where Major Applewhite upstairs looking down. He's got to give his quarterback a chance to make a throw and try to attack on the perimeter. With his athletic ability, it makes sense to run or throw, give him that option on an early down.
Without wide receiver Mike Davis. Hit on a release. And it is fourth down and goal. What a tremendous stand by the Kansas State defense.
And they brought the house. They rolled the dice here with Tom Hayes as a defensive coordinator. They brought everybody. They brought the corner, Randall Davis. Also, Blake Slaughter got there. He's the one that eventually put the pressure on Ash. And that's a win for Kansas State to force the field goal for Texas.
Farrah will kick it, but my favorite player in college football is going to snap it. That is Nate Boyer. A Bronze Star winner and a walk-on. Perfect snap. On its way. Texas strikes first for the 27. And there he is. Now look at that young man. Didn't play high school football. Never had a long snap in his life. And here he is snapping for field goals and punts. And ladies and gentlemen, stand up and applaud. He's a Bronze Star winner. And Texas settles for a field goal. They lead it 3-0. And now one of the things that Kansas State always does, are the great special teams, and Mack Brown very, very aware of this. That's Coach Aquina, works with the defensive backs here. Longtime assistant coach, Hawaiian, real good fella. Now this is the man to keep an eye on, Tyler Lockett. The junior from Tulsa, Oklahoma, familiar name to Kansas State fans, and they know just how good Tyler is. He's back with Thompson. Coach Snyder's son works with the special teams, and this is an area where they have always been good up in Manhattan. It'll be Rose, Nick Rose, who will kick it off. He'll have the kickoff duties here. Good coverage that time by the Horns.
Kept him inside the 20.
Well, NASCAR's chase to the Sprint Cup continues Sunday, New Hampshire. Points leader Matt Kenseth looks to build on his momentum and keep Kyle Busch and Jimmy Johnson from gaining ground. Don't miss the Sylvania 200 at New Hampshire. Tomorrow, 1 p.m. Eastern on ESPN. Also live on Watch ESPN. And Daniel Sams will come in. And this will be his first series as alternating quarterbacks, and he wants to take a look and see. Remember, BYU and Mississippi, their quarterbacks ran at will against this Horn defense. So what does Greg Robinson have for an answer?
Right tackle looked like he may have moved. Tavon Rooks got a little bit of an early start.
False start. Offense number 73. 5-yard penalty. It's first down.
And Coach Robinson saw right away they want to run that option.
So, yeah, and you could see Texas. They've been alerted all week that when four comes in, expect the option game. And it's because it's really hurt Texas the last couple weeks. And when four comes in, we change our philosophy. We've got to jam-pack the line of scrimmage. We've got to commit to the running game. Where they could leave themselves vulnerable is showing option from Kansas State and then throwing behind them. But Texas right now is locked in to stopping Daniel Sams in this running game.
Sams had a great high school career down in Louisiana. And there's the quarterback draw play, and there's his ability, folks, breaking free to the 35-yard line for a first down.
He follows the big fullback Gronkowski here. He just kind of a little bit of a quarterback draw, just waits for it to develop, open up some good blocks downfield, and very good effort. The timing was perfect. Kyle Klein picks up a block, the sophomore downfield. There's the difference in the feel from Daniel Sands. You and I saw him last year when Colin Klein went down with an injury against Oklahoma State. He's got tremendous athletic ability, but the thing I remember walking away from that night, he can throw the football.
A 23-yard run by the quarterback. Looking to run to the short side and across to about the 38-yard line. So we mentioned that Sams is from Louisiana. He's 6'2", 207 pounds.
And don't forget, not only his ability, but we cannot say it enough. This is a guy that coming into the game averages 8 yards a carry, and he's going up against a defense that has struggled. They gave up 550 rushing yards to BYU, 272 rushing yards to Ole Miss. They're the worst in the country at defending the run, and especially the quarterback run.
Hubert back in at running back. He gets the call, steps away from a defender, and gained about a yard on that play. Thompson makes his time. Well, let's go to Robert Flores for an update. Robert.
All right, Brent, time now for our Taco Bell Live Moss moment, and we'd like to welcome those of you who have been watching LSU and Auburn on ESPN. It's a rout early. Jeremy Hill, 3-2 touchdowns, 140 yards. It's 21-0 LSU over Auburn second quarter.
Now, Robert, and LSU next week goes to Athens, Georgia to take on the Dogs. And what a big one that figures to be. Third down and 6. Sam's going to burn a timeout right here.
First charge timeout, Kansas State.
So we'll take a break. Longhorns lead the Wildcats by a field goal. Coach Bill Snyder and Herbie in our talks, we ask him directly, would you use a down and distance situation to change quarterback? He didn't rule it out.
Right.
But so far, he uses quarterbacks for a series, and guess what? Here is Jake Waters on a 3rd and 6, trying to move quickly. Doesn't want Robinson and the coaches to get too adjusted. Now they're checking over on the sideline, the defensive players for the Horns. They know Waters is going to throw it. He does just that for a first down to Lockett. So there it is. He would kind of, you know, he kind of hid behind the answer a little bit.
He
never ruled it out.
Yep, and what he recognizes, blitz coming here from the boundary. They brought both an outside linebacker there, Jordan Hicks, and it left one-on-one to the outside. The ball is thrown to his outside shoulder, which allowed Lockett to catch the ball and then turn towards the boundary and pick up enough room for the first down.
Waters stays in. Hubert is the running back for the Wildcats. Good protection. Deflected, though. Incomplete.
Well, he really stared down his receiver on this play, and because of that, I think it made it pretty easy for Texas's defense to know what Waters wanted to do. Cedric Reed, the big defensive end, you can see he does a good job of getting off of Rooks, and then just goes up, times it up pretty well, gets that right paw up, and just knocks it down. But Kansas State sees something back into the boundary where they're trying to attack Lockett going up against Bindham in the top matchup at the top of the screen.
Jeffcoat is the defensive end in the two-point stance at the bottom. They run in his direction. It's jammed up and nothing doing. Third down and long coming up.
This is way too slow in developing with Jake Waters. With Colin Klein, maybe you can get away with this, but this play wasn't going anywhere. What a great job by Jeffcoat of just blowing up Andre McDonald and pushing him back and setting that edge for the defense. There was really nothing that Waters could do there. He just had to eat it, but that play had no chance from the beginning because of the way Jeffcoat played that. Waters should have just tried to cut underneath that.
Third down and 12. Incomplete, and tremendous coverage by Bindham. Carrington Bindham.
And this is the matchup we just talked about. It's the third time now they're trying to go after him. They try to set up a little bit of a pick there. Good effort by Bindham. He avoids the contact, gets his left arm in there. Lockett thought he got there a little bit prematurely.
So Shipley will again go in to return this punt by Krause. Mark Krause, the senior. Fair catch. at the 16-yard line. Well, tomorrow night on Sunday Night Baseball, as the regular season winds down, the St. Louis Cardinals to keep facing that red-hot NL Central when they face the Milwaukee Brewers. That's tomorrow, 8 o'clock. There is your standings. Cincinnati and Pittsburgh, they would be your wild cards right now. They are hot on the heels of the Cardinals. No one can afford to lose here if they come down this way.
It's getting interesting. Being a Reds fan, the Reds have one game with the Pirates tonight, another one tomorrow, and three more back in Cincinnati to finish up the regular season.
So Malcolm Brown steps in as a running back, gets the first carry, breaks the daylight. 14 yards. Barnett makes the stop. First down, Horns.
What great block by Trey Hopkins. Really good job opening that up. And Ash with this hurry-up offense, I think, caught Kansas State napping that time.
Hurry up, and they come back with him. And he blasts his way for 8 yards behind Walters, Espinoza, Hopkins.
That's why it's so important to have a couple backs when you run this tempo, because, you know, you give Gray a little bit of a break to bring in Malcolm Brown. He's had an ankle that he's had to fight through, but you can see a different energy by bringing this second back into this offense.
Second down and two. Ash back deep. Going to throw deep middle. Got a man open. Sanders, touchdown. Kendall Sanders walks in on the long ball from David Ash. 63 yards. Here's Farrah now on the field for the extra point. McCrary puts it down perfectly. And it is 10-0. The big play strikes for Mac Brown.
Major Applewhite told us that this is the man that they needed to really step up for him tonight because of the injuries. And I'll tell you what, Dorian Roberts, watch him. He doesn't get fooled at all. The problem is he can't stay with the speed of Sanders and the well-thrown ball that time by David Ash. Roberts didn't fall for the reverse. It wasn't as if he started to bite up. He tried to stay with him. He just didn't have the speed to stay with the fleet-footed Kendall Sanders. They wanted him to get off to a good start.
I think he's a little happy about that. That's coming through in a pressure cooker right there. And he's telling us that David Ash, by far the strongest arm on the team. And I should say, when you compare him with Case McCoy, he didn't get into a comparison with the freshman, Tyrone Swoops, but he said there's no comparison between Ash and McCoy on strength of arm. And we saw it right there. A beautiful downfield strike. A little daylight, a little breathing room here. But remember, Lockett and Thompson back deep now for the Wildcats. And they did a great job, this coverage team, the last time. They bottled Lockett up. Let me try it again. Going to swing it out to the left and see what he's got. 20, 30, 40, and slips down at the 44. And a penalty flag is thrown at the end of the play. We have a flag.
After the play was over, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, receiving team number 90. It's a 15-yard penalty from the end of the run, first down.
Costly 15 yards against Dowling on that fine return by Lockett.
Yeah, that was a big return and exactly what Kansas State needed.
They gave him a lift trailing
sure
by 10.
And Lockett always has that potential. You talked about that, Brent. I thought it might have been a block in the back, but it was one of these dead ball fouls that moves Kansas State way back to their own 27-yard line.
Sams will open this series. Let's see if the running quarterback can move the ball against this Greg Robinson coach defense. Remember when he came in last week, Well, we'll get back in on that. We've got another penalty. But when Robinson showed up last week, he had only 3 days. He said, listen, I was still learning names against Mississippi. But now he's had 10 days. He's had some time to make a few adjustments, reposition some players, and we'll see what we've got here tonight. He's a veteran, folks. Won a couple of Super Bowls at the Denver Broncos.
Personal foul, face mask, offense number 55. 15, after this correction, after this is for the goal.
That is guard Cody Whitehair, and that's two big penalties here. Somewhat unusual.
That's exactly what I was thinking. It's something, there he is right in the middle of the screen, gets his left hand up there, and then just pulls his helmet off. Very uncharacteristic of a Kansas State team coached by Bill Snyder.
But Snyder said, don't ever underestimate a Texas Longhorn football team. He knew he was going to get the best shot here tonight. Now he's got a first and 24. Hubert spins away from a would-be tackler. And let us check in with Robert Flores for an update. Robert.
All right, Brent. Michigan visiting Connecticut, and Devin Gardner puts them on top 7-0 with his 17-yard touchdown run. This game is on ESPN3 on a variety of platforms, so various ways to ignore your family on this Saturday night. Brent.
Thank you very much, Rob. Second down in. 18.
Doesn't it feel like this dual quarterback attack from Kansas State, they haven't been able to get into sync and settle down right now and figure out who's going to give them a better chance?
Maybe that's why coaches don't like it. Here comes Sam's. 30. This will be third and manageable. I mean, Snyder said he didn't like it. And he said, you guys at the end of the season may be criticizing me for it, but I just haven't found the one who can do it all right now.
And I think he's waiting for one of them to emerge. I'd be shocked if this lasted a whole year. But when you watch Sam's run, this looks like Bill Snyder's offense. I mean, if he can develop as a passer, this is what you would think. The characteristics of what you would think that fits in a little bit better with how Bill Snyder likes to attack. It's a big third down here.
The crowd very much into this game because of the early lead. Sam's looking to pass it. Now he takes off for the first down. A very patient run to the 40-yard line by the Kansas State quarterback, Steve Edmond, Mike linebacker with the style.
And by being patient, the right guard, Keenan Taylor, watch him. That's why he's being patient. He's just waiting for him to come around. And he was thinking about maybe just a threat of that pass to keep the safeties and the corners back. But it gives Taylor enough time to come around, picks up a nice block, and picks up that first down.
And the first quarter comes to an end. Texas with 10 points with an early lead here behind David Ash, a 63-yard pass into the first quarter. Back after this message and a word from your local ABC stations. But perhaps more importantly, Kansas State has rushed for only 53 yards in the first quarter. Now remember, both BYU and Ole Miss ran up and down the field on a Longhorn defense. So let's see how Greg Robinson's changes affect this defense as we start the second quarter. Bill Snyder's Wildcats with a first and 10. Sam's a running quarterback is back there. And he keeps it on first down, and guess what? Nothing doing. I mean, he was pounded, and Bindham cleans it up.
A great job of gap integrity by Texas, and also this secondary has heard it all week. They've got to come up and support when they see that action. Both the safety that time, Turner came up, and also Carrington Bindham. Good job of coming up and run support. Sam's had nowhere to go. They're being physical so far against this run.
Second down and 10. Sam's patient, twists away, can't get back to the line of scrimmage, pounded again. Jordan Hicks, the leading tackler, number 3, is up there defensively.
He fights through a lot of traffic that's in the interior. Great job right in the middle of the defense. Watch Hicks. Does a good job. He's an All-American. He actually got held. He fought through it, didn't give up on it. I'm going to tell you right now, when Sams gets in there, because he's a runner, Texas is selling out to stop Sams from running the football.
And here comes the thrower. Jake Waters, number 15 on third and 13, is back in. Fires downfield to the sideline, and the catch is ruled, but it's short of the first down. I think you can see our yellow line. Just a little short. And that's fourth down, and Bill Snyder will not gamble here.
No, no. And Waters, just to come off the bench like this on a third down and long, makes a pretty good throw to give his team a chance. But Bill Snyder, even though he's down 10, is not one of these risk takers that we seem to see all over college football. He's going to play it by the book and punt this ball away.
Krause to punt. Shipley's back deep for the Horns. Put a good rush on him. Shipley from the 14. Cuts up the middle of the field. 30. And out of bounds just short of the 40-yard line. Fine return. Horns will have the football when you come back to Austin. Well, welcome back to Austin, and with Kirkhurst Street, I'm Brett Musburger. Our Pacific Life game summary, pretty lopsided here, Herbie.
It is. Texas doing pretty much what they need to do on offense. You look at 50 yards rushing for Kansas State. I think another glowing stat, 27 yards passing. And right now, Daniel Sams, who's the running quarterback, hasn't completed a pass. So it's allowing Texas, without a threat of a pass game, to load up against the run, the area that really has been their Achilles heel these last couple weeks.
Jonathan Gray back in as the Horns running back. Remember, we told you, Major Applewhite said, he is our main man. We want to get him more touches. They didn't use him much in the second half against Ole Miss, and they paid a price. Here it is. And breaking back the other way, the quarterback, David Ash. Here's Shipley to block. Look at this reverse of field, and a first down for Gray. Boy, nobody was watching the backside for the Wildcats.
And they brought the blitz from the field, so the entire defense is flowing into the boundary. It's the perfect call that time by Tom Hayes. Everything that you want, except they didn't wrap up and bring Jonathan Gray down.
16-yard run for Gray. Play action again. Ash stands tall. Going to come deep again towards Sanders, who could not break free. Overthrew him just a little bit on that. Good one-on-one duel with Barnett.
Go back and look. You see the blitz? You see the pressure? Everybody's in position. They're right there. They pride themselves on gang tackling. They pride themselves on tackling as a group and as a team. That time there are four white jerseys right there at the point of attack. Nobody came up with it. Gray, to his credit, kept the play alive and picked up those big yards.
Malcolm Brown in off the sideline for Texas, number 28. He's in that backfield now with David Ash. Second down and 10. Remember, the Horns are without the leading receiver. That's Mike Davis. Ash going to take off. He's well short. A penalty flag comes down. The umpire throws it in the middle of the action.
Holding. Offense, number 75, 10-yard penalty, repeat second down.
That's guard Trey Hopkins.
Like so many of these spread attacks, Brent, with a guy who can run it and throw it, all Major Applewhite right now is doing is playing a numbers game. When he brings three receivers in, he just wants to see how Kansas State responds. And if they take too many guys to the outside in the passing game, they're running either their backs or they're going to run David Ash.
Second and 20. Ash looks toward his three, comes back on a screen to the boundary side of the field, and there's another penalty flag across the 25-yard line, but there is a penalty flag, so hold on.
Personal foul, leg whip, offense number 77, 15-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
Estelle, Kennedy Estelle, the right tackle.
Yeah, everything was pretty good on his block until the very end when he brought the leg whip into it. I mean, that's a screen pass. He's just trying to text off to the top of the screen right here. He's doing everything he can to try to sell. Hey, it's, you know, we're passing downfield. We're passing downfield. And then that right, or the right leg on the leg whip. Boy, Ryan Mueller having a tough night.
Oof.
Took the shot to the ribs.
Now he's got now a leg whip. It's a tough night for number 44. You are right. Oh, my. That gives the Horns a second and 35, and Joe Bergeron checks in as the Horns running back. He's the third running back used tonight. And they dump it off to Shipley and get it back across the 35-yard line. And Kip Daly makes the stop for the Wildcats.
Really love Jackson Shipley's quickness. You know, he's known to have great hands, a great route runner. But I really saw that punt return. Tremendous quickness. And with Mike Davis out of this game and Dajay Johnson out of this game, they look to Shipley and also Kendall Sanders to step up.
Third and a bunch. Drop it in underneath, and this will force a punt. Line of scrimmage will be at the 45-yard line. And Marcus Johnson with another grab for the Horns.
Yeah, just those last two plays, they didn't pick up a first down, but they affected field position. Just by getting the ball near midfield, it gives Farrah a much better chance of trying to pin back Tremaine Thompson and this dangerous return man.
Yeah, Thompson's backed up now to the Wildcats' 10-yard line as a result of that, Herbie. Exactly right. Farrah. Hangs it up, and it takes a big Horn bounce. It's that kind of a night, and out of bounds. And Bevo very happy that his lads jumped out on top. You're watching ESPN Saturday night. Come on, Bevo. Show some enthusiasm.
Saturday Night Football presented by Windows. Brought to you by UPS. Let UPS put the power of logistics to work for you. Buick. Visit your local Buick dealer to see why thousands of people are switching to Buick. And World War Z on Blu-ray Combo Pack today, rated PG-13 and unrated.
One of the great cities in the U.S., Austin, Texas, the 11th largest city. And Mac Brown says the Longhorns are Austin's professional team. And that indeed, in fact, I said it's like Columbus, Ohio, and the Buckeyes. And he said, indeed. Two very large cities without a professional football team. But boy, are they behind their college football team. Win or tie, as John Cooper would say.
Win or tie. Well, you know, Sam's is coming back out. And, Brent, he hasn't attempted a pass yet. And Texas is locked in that when they see four in the lineup, they're not going to let him run the football. They're going to do everything in their power to make him have to throw to beat them. See if Bill Snyder and Dana Demel come up with a little plan to try to break some tendencies in this running with four.
Check on the sideline. Looking at Robinson's alignment with the Horns defense. And there is he going nowhere.
Now when they see him get into this lineup, it's so far become pretty apparent. He's had some success, but when everything is run, after a week where this Texas defense has been hearing about it, here's man-to-man coverage. They have a safety in the middle that's just filling the alley against the option attack. You can see how the burnt orange jerseys are swarming against this run game. Eventually, without Jake Waters, I think Kansas State's going to have to be able to throw the ball.
There's a penalty flag.
Illegal substitution, offense number 83, breaking the huddle with 12. 5-yard penalty at second down.
And let's check in down below with Heather Cox.
Well, guys, can you imagine the craziness that has been Greg Robinson's life over the last 10 days? He was actually on his way to the airport to LAX when he picked up his phone, and it was Coach Brown calling saying, will you be my defensive coordinator? So he just kept driving with his overnight bag packed, flew to Austin, and here he is. He said he feels like he's been drinking out of a fire hose for the last 11 days. His challenge is as simple as learning names of his players to as complex as learning how to stop the run. I'd say he's pretty happy so far.
Yeah, indeed, Heather. It is second down at 15, and that run is going nowhere against his defense. To go back on Greg, you might recall that before he was the defensive coordinator for Mac Brown. He left prior to the 2005 season and became the head coach at Syracuse. And what happened to the Horns? They won the national championship. Greg told us, man, I wish I'd have stayed for just one more year, but I wanted to be a head coach. And off he went. Gene Chizik was the defensive coordinator.
The year that the Horns beat USC in a great football game at a Rose Bowl.
Waters is back in here on this third and 10.
Stands tall, delivers down the middle, complete. A beautiful throw by Waters. Herbie, that's his best throw of the game. And he picks up the first and 10.
Good job of reading the coverage here. It's a zone. They sit in the soft coverage. And because of that, there's a little bit of a hole there for him to be able to read and get the ball out of his hands. Nice job of selling it by Lockett. Quickness, accelerating upfield, breaks it across the middle. There's nobody underneath in coverage. And a good throw by Waters there.
When we say well coached, you saw him break that off just as Herbie describes it. He ran a beautiful route. Waters now goes deep, far sideline. Incomplete. That was now Thompson's turn, and it'll be second down. And Quandre Diggs, now he's the nickelback for Greg Robinson. And man, when you talk nickel here in Austin, think of the names, folks: Earl Thomas, Aaron Williams, Kenny Vaccaro. You're watching those three fellows on Sunday football, and here's Quandre Diggs.
Yeah, they're trying to get the ball downfield to try to stretch this defense and make them have to respect that, because right now they're crowding this passing game and crowding the running game. Waters stays in the lineup here.
Looks like Thompson goes shaken up, Herbie, when he went off the sideline. Second down and 10. Waters throws in underneath and completes it, and that's out to about the 34-yard line where it'll be spotted. And there is Tyler Locke. Interesting young man, loves to write poetry. And gives little speeches to the team. Fascinating. And of course, with Chris Harper gone from this team, Lockett and Thompson really have to step up this year. Third down and 5 now. All 5 of his receptions to Lockett by Jake Waters in this game. He's going to follow Hubert nowhere. He ran to darkness that time. Big Malcolm Brown.
Kansas State struggling up at the line of scrimmage. Malcolm Brown, 305 pounds. We've seen Desmond Jackson pushing some people around. When Kansas State gets behind the sticks and they become predictable with their play calling, they're not going to have a whole lot of success against a more athletic Texas defensive front.
Shipley back deep again, and they continue to put pressure on the Kansas State punter. And this is a beautiful punt. Coming back inside the 20. Shipley tries to get an alley. Going to go down at the 24-yard line. Oh, yeah. Lots of happy defenders so far, Herbie, on this Texas team. Welcome back to Austin. Here comes Affleck. Who was Texas' starting quarterback the last time they defeated Kansas State? They lost 5 in a row. Didn't play him every year when there were 2 divisions in the Big 12. Got to go back a decade. Okay. And that's all the hints I'm
giving. Okay.
Our Affleck trivia question of this night. Jonathan Gray is your running back. Pocket and throw it underneath.
One thing they're doing a really good job of is, while Kansas State so far offensively is fairly predictable and vanilla, Texas, with this up-tempo offense, a variety of formations, spreading it out and keeping Kansas State guessing.
Now Slaughter injured on that sideline, taken out. Gray, who caught that ball, now runs for the first down. Gray starting to stand up as a go-to guy. Ty Zimmerman, we haven't mentioned the name of the fine veteran for the Wildcats tonight. He makes that stop.
What a run there. That time he just shook Dante Barnett. Barnett, the safety, was there to make the play. Next thing you know, Gray shook him and he was buying.
Here comes Gray again. Third straight time he's handled the ball.
They're just doing a really good job of keeping Kansas State on their heels. The tempo will do that, but the variety of formations and personnel groups with the tempo, with a quarterback that can run and throw, it just right now they're hitting them in a lot of different areas.
Quick handoff. Here he comes again across midfield, trying to pick up the first down. Stopped a little bit short of it.
The other thing is, Kansas State looks like they're just outmanned up front. I mean, Texas is taking the attack at the line of scrimmage and just pushing Kansas State back.
David Ash straight ahead, and the pile moves behind Espinoza, Walters, and Hopkins for that first down. And Herbie, just as you said it, they did push that front around.
And right now, you start to get lulled to sleep because they're kind of they're throwing some short passes. They're running the football. The safeties are going to start to fall asleep. They're going to start to come into the running game, and then that's where they'll try to hit a home run over the top.
And then the corners back off. They knew that Ash was going to try to throw it.
That's right.
And he's sacked on that play as a result. Reed takes Ash down. The corners backed off. And they picked up the speed on the outside.
Yeah, they sat back, as you said. We thought, I think we're all feeling the same thing. This is a great time. See the little pump fake? He wanted to go downfield. He wanted to take a shot down the right sideline because he had his man Kendall Sanders, who he hit earlier for that big touchdown. But give Kansas State credit. I think they were feeling that same thing, sunk way back in coverage and brought pressure.
Second and 18, and they flare to the outside with Gray again. And he crosses midfield, and we get back to that original line of scrimmage. And so the ball is going to be on the K-State 45-yard line, and it'll bring up third down and 10. One touchdown in this game, 63-yard pass to Kendall Sanders from David Ash. Malcolm Brown's a running back for this third down. Watch to see if he circles out. Coming off his block, but Ash is going to try to run for it, and he's short. Got close, though. Picked up a good 8 yards on that play, I think they're going to go here.
With the way this game has gone, Mac Brown should go for this.
Fourth down and 2. The ball at the 37-yard line. And the Horns have run for almost 100 yards and pass for another 137. Major Applewhite trying to dial up the play here. David Ash, very dangerous in this situation. Shipley, of course, the slot receiver.
Gonna let the clock run down. They had their arm on Bergeron, who's their short yardage back. They're thinking about maybe sending him in, and now they just call that timeout and think it over.
With 4th and 2, 3:54, the Horns lead it by 10 over Kansas State. Herbie, time's up for the Aflac trivia question. It was a starting quarterback for Texas the last time they defeated Kansas State.
I got to say it's Vince Young.
All right, close, but that's wrong. Chance Mock started that night.
Okay,
Vince Young did see extensive action.
Okay.
And he did lead them to a win. But Chance Mock was the Texas quarterback 2001 to 04. I had forgotten all about that rest.
I completely forgot.
Yeah.
One time he had the full Grizzly Adams beard going, too, Chance Mock.
And look who's here, Vince Young.
There you go.
Down on the sideline. He led him to that win, but he did not start it. So Joe Bergeron is the power running back. Here we come now. 4th down and 2 for the Horns. Backfield goes empty. Fire, Shipley, first down, move the chains to the 26-yard line. Nice call.
Yep, they motion out the running back, and the linebacker went with him. And when he went with him, it made such a huge opening there. Easy throw, easy read that time for David Ash.
Here comes tempo now. Ash dumping back off. Underneath to the running back, Joe Bergeron. Remember, he's on the field. Evans with the stop for Kansas State. We've stealing a page from Chip Kelly. The signs are being held up on the Longhorn sideline as they quickly signal that play in. Jonathan Gray in from the sidelines. There you have it.
Oh, the signs.
Chip is finding out not quite so easy in the National Football League as it was up in Eugene. Here comes Gray now. Swinging, steps out, first down, beautiful vision. Touchdown, Texas. That's why he's the go-to back, folks. Watch this cut. When he spots the hole, it's 21 yards, touchdown Horns.
Well, he just has that combination of some size with some power. He's elusive and quick. That time, Brent, you said watch him find his hole. He bounced that to the outside. The vision there was his best attribute, finding that to the outside, and then the speed to get to the corner.
I'm sure Mississippi was very happy not to see him much in the second half last week. Farrah tacks on the extra point.
Go back to that 4th down and short where they motioned the back out of the backfield, and the, see the backer follow him. When he follows him, look at the vacancy there in that zone coverage. What a catch by Shipley to convert there on fourth down. And then, again, there's the route, the hands, gets down to protect himself from the safety. And then here's how he bounces this. Gets some good blocks downfield by Shipley. Also had Kendall Sanders, who made a block and then got his hands up. I didn't push him in the back. But look how he bounces it right there to the outside. And then there's the speed. He's a special back, Jonathan Gray.
A huge 3 minutes coming up here for Kansas State. They've been dominated so far here in the first half. It's 17-0 Horns. Bill Snyder and the offensive coaches would dearly love even a field goal. Just get something to build on here in the second half.
And he deferred, so he does get the ball to start the second half. So this is a big series for Bill Snyder. Could not have gone any worse for his offense in the first half.
Absolutely.
Very, very predictable.
Greg Robinson's adjustments paying off for the Horns defensively. They've given up only 101 total yards here in the first half. Here comes Lockett. From 3 yards in, he's going to come out and rustle down at the 19-yard line. Great coverage again. Let's check in with Robert Flores.
All right, Dr. Pepper 10 conference update. Big 10 against American, and UConn has tied this game up. Chandler Whitmer to Spencer Parker. They're tied at 7 late first half against number 15 Michigan. Brent.
Robert, the future, though, looks bright for the Big Ten. Think about Maryland and Rutgers today.
There you go. Reaching deep
first
for some victories.
Jake Waters comes in. He'll see if he can rally the Wildcats here. John Hubert, the running back, directly behind him. They've got two timeouts, plenty of time. Play action. Waters going to give it to Hubert, and he's thrown for a loss. All over him. Jordan Hicks, that outstanding linebacker.
Still a simple attack in Texas. We talked earlier about Greg Robinson. One of the greatest things that he did in his short time that he's been here is he's inherited Manny Diaz's system, but he's really streamlined the attack. He wants his guys to play fast. He wants to keep it simpler. Let them just pin their ears back. But they are dialed in right now on what Kansas State's attempting to do on offense.
Second down and 12. Waters from the pocket goes downfield. Got Lockett. Got him beautifully. At the 36-yard line, it'll be a first down, Kansas State. A huge play.
And just as we say that they're dialed in, finally there's a chance for Waters to make a play. One-on-one coverage. There's the arm strength from Jake Waters. Isolated against Duke Thomas, and Tyler Lockett got behind him. The ball's thrown right over his shoulder. Great throw by Waters.
47-yard gain on that play. Waters quickly changes it up at the line. Hubert now moves over to his right. And there was play was stopped.
Prior to the snap, Texas calls their second charge timeout. 30 seconds.
So at 1:43, they use their second timeout, and why not? Coming up now, stay tuned for the Capital One halftime report. Scores and highlights from around college football. You know, I was going to needle our friend Jesse Palmer, but I can't. Mettenberger is playing so well for LSU, but I was going to say to him, where was A.J. McCarron on your top five quarterbacks?
He had Manziel
at the top of the did not have McCarron in the top five. However, you know, he's right about Mettenberger. He had him listed number five.
That's a, Zach Mettenberger right now is executing probably as well as anybody when it's just efficiency. About as well as anybody in the country.
Absolutely.
A.J. McCarron, because of what he did and where he did it last week.
I agree.
That was impressive.
Yeah, I thought so.
They're down.
You know, you got Mariota.
Yeah, this is a year.
Well, it is a year for the quarterback.
Interesting.
That's
year.
Why the Cleveland Browns made a big trade, I'm sure.
That's right.
First down and 10 now. Here comes Waters. Firing complete to Lockett again to the 15-yard line. And the Wildcats are in business. Through the air.
They're going to have to go through the air to open things up. Late pressure this time by Michael Thompson. Good job of picking it up. And Lockett right now is winning the battle on the outside against Duke Thomas in one-on-one coverage.
What crisp moves by Lockett.
Really,
when he turns on a corner, I mean, he comes with authority.
Quick, but a really efficient route runner.
Big, big drive. 1:10 coming up now. First down and 10 for the Wildcats, trying to get on the board here. Here comes Hubert. Behind Gronkowski, block, 5, touchdown, Kansas State. Oh, what a huge drive for Bill Snyder.
Well, you talked about that before they started, but the passing game opened things up for them to get back to who Bill Snyder is, and they were able to control on that play, control things up front for the first time in a long time in his football game. And we were talking at a break, when are they going to get little 33 the football? When his John Hubert's probably one of their best players on the field. He hasn't touched the ball much. That's his fourth carry. That time they gave him a little bit of room to work with, and you can see the acceleration once he saw that seam, whoo, into the end zone.
Jack Cantelli. His brother Anthony was a mainstay for years. Jack tacks on the extra point. Let's see. There was a flag down, I think, prior to the kick. Let's see.
Offside, defense, number 6. Have the distance to the goal. Try for point.
I like this referee a lot. He talks with authority, knows what he's doing.
Yeah.
National Football League might want to take a look.
No,
at
let's
this
keep
fellow.
Him here. I like him here.
Try for point.
I was talking to him on the field before the game. Yeah. He is all business. Really like it.
Looks like he's all business.
Total control.
I like the announcements and how he handles things out there. Looks like he's been pumping a little iron there.
Don't chase him to the NFL. After last week in Tempe, we need all the officials we can get.
You got that right, my friend. We'll be talking about that at the Wisconsin Ohio State game next week. All right, tax on the extra point now. What a great drive here by the Wildcats.
4 plays, 82 yards, a lot of it through the air, which set up this play. This is the first time Hubert's been able to get to the outside. They've tried to stretch him horizontally, and then it creates the vertical seams. He's able to find this great vision, and right there, that quick acceleration. Texas can run on defense, and that time Adrian Phillips didn't have a chance, as fast as he is at safety, to come down and make a play against a very quick John Hubert.
You saw the shot of Robinson with his Mike linebacker talking about that last drive also. And so here's the drive chart, Herbie. What a difference.
And here it is. The first possession, second, third, and fourth, going back and forth with the quarterbacks, trying to figure out what would be the answer. Remember, Texas came into this game. They couldn't stop the running game. Well, it was the passing game in the last series of plays for Kansas State that got them down the field.
Remember now, there's still a minute left on this clock. So a good return here. And the horns might see if they can do something. They're up by 10. And that kickoff is off short. Top of the killer clock by getting out of bounds over there. There's a penalty flag down. Did he catch that ball out of bounds?
He did, but the ball went out of bounds, I think, maybe before he did catch it.
Let's see here.
Our guy here's all over it, though. He's got
He was up there.
Free kick out of bounds by the kicking team. The ball will be placed at the 35-yard line, first and 10.
Bill Snyder's just got to be looking at himself thinking, when it comes to penalties, when it comes to turnover margin, when it comes to special teams, these are areas we have to win if we're going to go to Austin, Texas and beat Mack Brown. They've won 5 in a row because those are the areas where they've been able to beat Texas. And in the first half, not only did their offense, was it slow in starting, but to look at these, you know, the penalties and some of the mistakes that they've made, it's just not like Kansas State.
Malcolm Brown is the running back here. Yes, indeed. Ash is going to try to put it up to see if they can get something going out of bounds. Johnson.
Remember last week they were up 23-17 against Ole Miss at halftime, and then they ended up getting blown out in the second half. Mac Brown's thinking this 10-point lead is not even close to being enough. Let's keep attacking here.
Yeah, because in the second half, Herbie was 1-3 and out after another. Offense could not move the ball. I got to tell you something. The Ole Miss defensive front was really impressive in that game. Second down and 4. Pocket holds. Juggling, incomplete. Walker, linebacker. That was Trey Walker.
Rush 4, drop 7. Just a poor execution that time by David Ash. I think the thing that I've seen from David Ash in this first half is when he gets back and gets the ball out of his hands, he makes plays. When he's back there and you give him time to think and sit there, hitch, it doesn't seem to have the same rhythm and flow for this offense.
They're down at 4. Ash on the quarterback draw has the first down. And more. Stopping the clock at the 48-yard line. 45 seconds, and now they're in business to see if they can hustle down and at least get a field goal attempt here.
A great athlete, and the quarterback draw is a call that Major Applewhite saves for the right time. They're on third down, and you can see the confidence that Ash has when they do call the draw. The execution perfect. Got the center Espinoza in the back that time. Malcolm Brown up front of the linebackers.
4 wide. Nash again going to shovel it forward, and that's the Malcolm Brown.
The one timeout left here. Mac Brown kind of saying, let's go. Come on, let's run a play. We got to save that timeout.
And if they got to hustle the field goal unit on the field, let's see. There's now second down and 3. Nash is back. Receivers are out. He's got time. Can't find anybody open. Fires and broken up on that far side by Roberts.
That was a great play. Dorian Roberts got beat earlier tonight on the big touchdown by Kendall Sanders. He's been giving a lot of soft coverage to these speedy wide receivers from Texas. And because of that, he's got to have an ability to break on the ball quickly. That time he showed the quickness and been able to knock that football away.
You take a look at that Gree line. They've got to get to that to match the career long of Farrell. So there is your line that you must get to. With 20 seconds, third down and 3. Short of it, incomplete.
And a clean hit by Kansas State.
With 14 seconds left, that brings up a 4th and 3. Slaughter. Boy, and he did slaughter it.
He did.
He
lowered the boom. And these players have been hearing since training camp about not hitting a defenseless player. He stayed low. This is great technique this time. You see where he hits him right in the chest. That's a great job by Slaughter. He was out earlier with an injury. Comes back. Boy, he popped him, hit him. That's textbook on how to hit a receiver who's a defenseless player, but he hit him in the chest, so it's clean.
Now, timeout is called by Kansas State on this 4th down. Remember, Texas has a timeout. It is 4th down and 3, and the Wildcats want to talk about it with the defensive coaches over there. Mike Cox, the linebacker coach, he is upstairs talking to the defensive coordinator, Tom Hayes. You mentioned him down on the field. And, of course, Bill Snyder. They want to make sure that they have their defense set here. Texas, remember, has that timeout.
Also, David Ash, who missed last week because of a concussion, for the most part, he's held up and hasn't had to come out, obviously, in his football game. But it looked like he was wincing there a little bit when he was coming over to the sidelines. They wanted to, with a week off against Ole Miss, they wanted to just get him in a position to get the ball out of his hands and have quick throws and rhythm. And I think you got to give them some credit for having a chance to accomplish that for the most part in this first half. Kansas State, not a pressure team, not bringing any blitz. They're just going to rush 4.
Nash backing up, cut off, throws under pressure and almost intercepted. So it will be Kansas State football with 8 seconds remaining, and you would think they would be content at this point to go on in down 10.
Yeah, and I just said how they're rushing 4, they're not blitzing, and yet Ash still felt, I think, some pressure that time and had to get away from it and just kind of trying to check it down to his running back. But that's a big stop for Kansas State. They get the touchdown. They get within 10. Now they go in at halftime. They get the football to start the second half, and they can go back to the drawing board. Every drive they had, they want to forget about, except that final drive where they were able to put points on the board. And again, it was through the air that allowed them to move the ball down the field.
Mueller made a good play defensively for the Wildcats. They're going to spread the field here with 8 seconds to go. They got Jake Waters. Run back to the left, and he's going to throw it out of bounds as time runs out on the first half. Jackson Jeffcoat applying pressure, big number 44. His daddy's here tonight, an assistant coach with the Colorado Buffaloes. Has an off night, so he's traveled down to see his son. 17-7, but again, as Herbie pointed out, a very important seven for the Wildcats.
We got a second half.
Let's check in now with Heather Cox and Mac Brown.
Brent, thank you. Coach, after giving up 822 yards of rushing the last 2 weeks, have allowed just 68 tonight. What's been the biggest change?
Biggest change is attitude and effort. The guys are playing with a lot of confidence, Heather, and that's the most important thing right now.
And David Ash and the offense certainly helping. How would you assess David Ash and his return?
I thought David has played tremendously well. He hasn't turned the ball over. He's made good decisions. He's made plays with his feet. We just got to keep doing it. We've been the fourth quarter with this bunch the last 2 years and let him off the hook. So we've got to win the fourth quarter this year.
Mac, thanks so much.
Thanks, Heather. That's the end of the first half here at Austin, Texas. And stay tuned now after these messages for the Capital One Halftime Report. Second quarter, they are evaluating him right now. That is a big development in this football.
It is, and Texas knew coming in as they prepared for this week. They were hoping David Ash would be able to go four quarters, but they knew you're coming off a concussion and you're playing quarterback in this offense, there's a chance he may get dinged and have to get reevaluated. So they've got a plan in place for Case McCoy to see what he can do. And we'll see how McCoy does, because Mac Brown told me on the field right before the game that if McCoy goes in and struggles, they'd be willing to consider bringing in Tyrone Swoops, the true freshman, to give him a chance as well, depending on how the ebb and flow of the game will go.
Yeah, he said, we're not worried about redshirt. We're worried about winning.
That's right.
So that will be the situation here right now. And Kansas State will handle the ball to begin the second half. They deferred after winning the flip, and they'll have it out on the 25-yard line. So let's take a look at our Pacific Life game summary. Herbie, you asked for it. A comparison of the quarterbacks for Kansas State.
Yeah, and I think we all saw that Jake Waters late in the first half put the drive together. You can see he led them to their only touchdown. But if Daniel Sams does come back into the game at some point, he's going to have to throw the football. And I think this offense overall is going to have to throw the football to open up their running game, whether it's option or running John Huber.
The pass dropped by our box, Colin Klein, to say hello. He is in attendance here tonight watching. And Hubert gets the first call into the middle of that defense. And let's go down now to Heather Cox.
Brent, more information on Texas quarterback David Ash. I've just been told he is out for the game with a head injury. Has re-aggravated that concussion he suffered 2 weeks ago against BYU. He will not return. You're looking at Case McCoy the rest of the ballgame, guys.
So Case McCoy, it'll be his turn, but right now the Wildcats have the first series of the second half. So it is second and seven, down 10, 17-7. Waters going to take off. Great scramble for him out to the 45-yard line. Coach Snyder said, you know, he's not a scrambler, but he can take off and pick up yards.
He can. You mentioned Colin Klein. He made this play last year, last couple years, happened so many times. A quarterback counter. It is a slow-developing play. It gives the fullback a chance to get around, the backside guard a chance to get around and lead around the right side. And Waters shows some speed and athletic ability enough there to attack this Texas defense.
A 17-yard gain. Option look. Pitch now to Huber. And Hubert run out of bounds after he picked up 3 yards, and that was Thompson, the safety.
I think the key for Kansas State, and probably part of what they looked at halftime, is when Jake Waters is in there, they've got to break some tendencies. They're very predictable for most of the first half. When Waters is in, they look to try to throw the football early, and Texas knew that. Waters is going to have, at some shots, chance to run the ball and then get back to throwing, which is what he's known for.
Must reach the Longhorns' 45-yard line for a first down. They fire incomplete. Lockett couldn't hang on. He had a huge, huge first half. Seven catches for 117 yards, and he just could not get the handle on this one.
He's against Carrington. Bind him. He does it again. Another great route. Gets to the inside. Perfect route. Great execution, other than he just didn't hold on to the football. These Texas cornerbacks, when they've been isolated one-on-one against Tyler Lockett, have lost almost every battle. That time they were lucky he just dropped the ball.
Wildcats may come again. Third down and eight. Waters steps up, fires, this time got the first down. And he did indeed throw back to Lockett.
And a great job, and number one, going back to Lockett, but stepping up in the pocket right in the middle of the mess. Look at that pocket form around him. Like all great pocket quarterbacks, he's comfortable coming out of the junior college ranks. He steps up into it and delivers a strike going back to his man, Tyler Lockett.
So Waters comes out flinging here. He's 9 of 15 for the game. Again, picking daylight. And out of bounds after about a yard, bringing up now second down and nine.
You go back to that end of that first half where Kansas State, Brent, you touched on it. It was a pivotal drive where they needed some points, and Waters looks off the safety to give himself a little bit more room, just enough to throw it over the shoulder of Lockett, and then that opened up some running lanes. You can see the separation there and the acceleration there for the touchdown by John Hubert.
Facing a second down, they need to reach the 34-yard line of the Horns for a first down. Checking up at the sideline with Bill Snyder's offensive staff. Option. Fumble, Texas football. Hubert fumbled the pitch, and it was recovered by Desmond Jackson, 99, the junior from Houston.
Brent, pretty good execution by Waters. I don't know if Hubert took his eyes off the ball or what it might have happened there. Or I don't know if Michael Thompson maybe got a hand on it. He didn't get a hand on it at all. He just simply dropped the football.
You know, Coach Snyder has been a little critical of Hubert so far to start this season. He'll be even more critical after he sees that replay. And, oh, by the way, we may see a little bit more of Robert Rose as a running back after that. All right, now Case McCoy is the quarterback. Starter David Ash out again. Symptoms of a recurring concussion. Handoff now to Gray. Gray cuts back. And remember, Herbie, you said it during the halftime intermission when folks were away. They had a big lead on Ole Miss at the intermission a week ago.
23-17. With Case McCoy coming in, what you lose is the threat of the quarterback run game, which David Ash had some success with in the first half, whether it was design run or scrambles to keep plays alive and try to use his feet. You don't have that same athletic ability with McCoy.
Second and seven. Great. Barrels straight ahead, and this will be third and short coming up. Zimmerman makes the stop for the Wildcats.
The reason that's important, Brent, is it allows Tom Hayes to lock his defense in on the quick throws to the outside and more of just the running backs running the football.
It's going to be Gray again. Slips. Did not get the first down. Big call coming up here for Mac Brown and the Horns. This is a fourth down call.
With a lead, you think Mac Brown, he's going to punt the ball.
Punt team in.
Punt the ball and make Kansas State have to get their offense back out there and move. This crowd a little restless, but hey, fans, you're up by 10.
You're
up by 10. The ball's at midfield.
This is sound football.
Yeah.
No question about it. Anthony Fair, crowd always wants you to go, but the buzz wasn't too loud.
No. And John Cooper used to say, y'all want to gamble, but you want to gamble with my chips.
They just fight. They fake it.
Oh.
For a first down, they go to the short man. How about this? Called it at the right time. Alex De La Torre was the up back, the fullback from nearby Denton, Texas, just outside of Dallas.
How about Mac Brown? He says, I will gamble with my chips. How about that? And again, for Kansas State.
He didn't cross you and me up. I mean,
for Kansas State, you got to win what? The turnover margin and special teams. Field position, all the little things that add up. There's another special teams advantage for Texas here in this game.
And there's a penalty flag on this play as they barrel straight away. It's interesting now. That's usually something that Bill Snyder and the Wildcats have an advantage in. But here, special teams going to Mac Brown and the Horns. And Snyder cannot be happy. First, a fumble, remember.
Offside by the right defensive end. 5-yard penalty.
You know, they've beaten Texas five straight times. They're 7-2 against Mack Brown. And I bet you if you and I went back and looked at their seven wins against Mack Brown, you would see those things. They would win the special teams battle. They would win the turnover margin. All the little things. And tonight that has not gone their way.
Here comes Gray. Picks his daylight. This will be second down and short after that penalty, which of course made it first and five. Reed with the stop. And so there is just what Herbie is talking about. And you can see the turnover margin, Herbie, is unbelievable.
It is. To think about Mack Brown 2-7 against Kansas State. And the turnovers have been a big part of that.
Second down and four. Big 12 opener for both these teams. K-State, the defending Big 12 champion. And Gray bangs ahead. So Major Applewhite telling us that this is the young man who's going to get the call in the second half. We need to keep him going. What we saw on tape about Gray is he picks daylight better than the other running backs.
The guys up front are sustaining their blocks. They've lost the threat of the quarterback run, becoming a little bit more predictable with the running back running, doing a great job of controlling it up front.
Coming right back with 32, a full dose. Touchdown, Texas. So Gray goes over 100 yards today and has scored two touchdowns, 113 yards. Good call by Major Applewhite to give him the football in the second half.
This could be proved to be a big night, not just for Texas if they're able to win this game, but Jonathan Gray starting to really assert himself within this offense. A big night tonight so far.
His second touchdown. There he is, cutting to daylight, untouched to the end zone. How'd you like it, Mac? Major Applewhite, remember, has now gone upstairs. He was down on the field when the season started. He gets a cleaner look at all 22. A little bit quieter up there for your play caller. Mack Brown wanted him upstairs. Major agreed he should be upstairs. 24-7 now.
What a luxury having a backup quarterback who started some games, and they didn't miss a beat as far as the tempo and the execution of that offense when Case McCoy came into the game.
Lockett is back deep. They come out on the 25-yard line.
Go back. Don't forget the fake punt. Look at Garrett Porter, big 73. Boom! He just submarines and buries the guy. But that was fourth down, deciding the fake punt. And then here's a great block right here by the left tackle, Donald Hawkins. The linebacker actually takes himself out of the play by shooting a gap. And here's a good block right here by the wide receiver on the outside to open it up by Marcus Johnson. And then there's the vision. We've seen it all night from Jonathan Gray. He bounced it back into the middle and has some serious juice for his size.
McCoy talking on the phone to Major Applewhite upstairs. Colt McCoy's younger brother discussing what they're going to continue to do. He's replaced David Ash. Jake Waters with Kansas State behind 24-7. They leave the passing quarterback in, and on first down, deflected. It'll be second down and 10 coming up. The Mike linebacker right there. Now I want to talk about the defensive coordinators here. And I want you to take a look at the average points. Greg Robinson, the year before, they won a Rose Bowl over Michigan. Gene Chizik was here from 05 to 06. And Will Muschamp, remember, came in. But look at the points. Robinson allowed 17.9. Chizik, 17.3. Yards, Muschamp, only 297. But all of those fellas are down from what Manny Diaz was doing here with the defense. So that is why Mack Brown made the change. Now, taking off is Waters. And Waters is across the 30-yard line. This will bring up a third down. Herbie.
Yeah, and I think another thing that had to do with that defense and their dominance was the continuity that they had as a group when they changed from one coordinator to the other. The other thing is you love the NFL. A lot of guys who played on some of those defenses play on Sundays from some of those players, those teams that they had in that era.
Third down and 6.
You don't know if he's disguising or if he's showing pressure here. It's kind of safety, that Josh Turner sneaking up there.
Waters from the pocket, in trouble, and down. K-State is forced to punt. Play has been whistled down at the 30-yard line.
And Waters, with his background, is comfortable. We've seen him make a lot of plays tonight from the pocket, but at some point he's got to know when to get out of there. I mean, you respect that he wants to try to give this play a chance, but at some point you'd like to see him try to get out of away from some of that pressure instead of just sitting there waiting for a receiver to open up downfield. But great coverage downfield by Texas' secondary.
Again, they're all over that punter. He goes down. No penalty flag. Shipley with the catch. Krause was banged up, but there was no flag on that play. Wow.
Saturday Night Football presented by Windows. Brought to you by Pacific Life. For insurance, annuities, and investments, choose Pacific Life, the power to help you succeed. Ford. Only Ford gives you EcoBoost fuel economy and a whole lot more. And Axe. Girls are getting hotter. Keep your cool with new Axe Black Chill.
The Longhorn Network celebrated its second year on the air down here in Texas. That was in August. Doing a fine job. Folks, Coach Bill Snyder has a beef. You've got to protect punters. And the rush man got through, and Reggie's over. The first time I'm going to second guess the referee tonight.
Watch the
face. You got a call, a penalty. They're very exposed after they punt the ball. I'm telling you right now.
Yeah. Bill Snyder evidently did not like the explanation. That was fourth and five, so it wouldn't have mattered if it was running into the punter or roughing the punter. It would have been a first down for the Cats.
Meanwhile now, first and 10 for McCoy. Here comes McGray. So Jonathan Gray bursts again. Trey Walker making the stop. What a night he's having early.
What a great block by Malcolm Brown. Yeah, he's a tailback, but he lined up as a fullback. Felt the blitz right away by Randall Evans and picked it up, pushed it into the inside, and allowed the back, Gray, to bounce it outside.
Major Applewhite, in describing why he wanted Gray on the field, said he has the burst, he can change direction, he can turn a 7-yard gain into a 15-yard gain, and Gray here tonight has rushed for 125 yards and 2 touchdowns. Malcolm Brown gives him a little bit of a breather here. Malcolm is thrown for a loss. There's Mueller in there saying, don't you go away from me, man. I got you.
Yeah, that time the defensive line just taking a little bit of a risk. They're a bit overmatched tonight. They're slanting and angling. That time they slanted towards the sidelines. And they guessed right. They're able to slip by the right tackle, Kennedy Estelle, and Ryan Mueller using his quickness that time to make that play. Case McCoy has not attempted a pass yet since he's been inserted into the lineup here in the second half.
But Major Applewhite is keeping the clock running. Yep. There is the first pass. Shipley picks up a few yards on it, and Kip Daly. We've said Kip Daly's name a lot here, Herbert.
We sure have. You know, he's one of these new corners that when they go to nickel, he's got to be out there on an island quite a bit. He had 2 interceptions last week. We said earlier he took one of them back for a touchdown against UMass. And if Kansas State wants to get back into this football game, here's a third and long. They got to get the ball back to their quarterback, Jake Waters.
On third and 11, McCoy throws downfield for the first down to Kendall Sanders, who had a big 63-yard touchdown pass from Ash in the first half.
He's so worried about getting beat deep that on third and 10, look at that soft coverage. Didn't even get challenged off the line. He turned around at 11 or 12 yards, and the ball's thrown. Easy execution for Texas there on third down and 10. I respect you got to be worried about these guys getting behind you, but in third and long, I want to tighten it up a bit.
First down and 10, and they continue to use Malcolm Brown.
It's third down and 10. You can see the corner. Roberts already giving him a big cushion, and then he's bailing. He's dropping back. Maybe he's having a lingering effect from that big touchdown he gave up earlier to that same receiver, Sanders.
Now for Brown for the first down, across the 30-yard line. You can see they have brought the clock down in the third quarter already to 5:22.
How about those big boys up front? I mean, just really having their way against Kansas State, pushing them. And I think it's been a good job of mixing in not just a balanced attack, but to the outside, back to the inside.
Play action. McCoy, incomplete. Second down and 10. Ryan Mueller again, and there is Hicks, the outstanding linebacker, and he is being carted off the field. Remember, they've already lost starting quarterback David Ash. Hicks, he needs to stay healthy and stay on the field here for the Longhorns. They really count on him.
Yeah, he has had to fight through some injuries in his career. Out of Cincinnati, Ohio, came all the way down to play for the Texas Longhorns.
Second down and 10. Hand off to Brown, and now it's going to be third down and long coming up here for Case McCoy. But again, they bring that clock down inside of 5 minutes, 24-7. Horns with the lead.
Back in the old days, we'd come in here and it'd be Colt McCoy and Jordan Shipley on third down and 9. And Case McCoy has that same relationship with Jackson Shipley, who'll be closest to him on the left side here. See if number 8 can make a play.
Looking in that direction. Pump fake, don't come back. Nothing doing. That was jumped beautifully that time by Blake Slaughter.
And that time on third down, Kansas State did bring pressure. They did tighten up the coverage on the outside. And as you said, really good job of just sniffing this out. This screen never had a chance. The linebacker locked in to the running back. Blake Slaughter is there before the back had a chance to really even catch the football.
So here comes your 45-yard field goal attempt by Anthony Ferro. Made one earlier. 27 yards. Pulls this one to the left. No good. And it'll come back out to about the 28-yard line for Kansas State. So the Wildcats get the ball back after the missed field goal, and you're watching ESPN Saturday Night Football on ABC. College football buses here, and a reminder, the tailgate week fired up by Kinks for Charcoal is coming October 5th. Our driver, Matt Bull, will be pulling away and headed for Columbus, Ohio, where next week we will have Wisconsin and Ohio State on ABC at 8 Eastern. Jake Waters still in the quarterback here. 24-7, Texas with the lead over Kansas State. Wildcats with that one touchdown drive late in the second quarter. Otherwise, they have been dominated by Greg Robinson's new look defense here for the Horns. Sideline complete to Lockett. And let's check in with Robert Flores for an update. Robert.
An early third quarter, Devin Gardner, another fumble. Tymir Brown, scoop and score. The Huskies led 21-7. Wolverines have answered. They're down 21-14, third quarter.
Yeah, Robert, and they ducked a bullet, the Wolverines did last week against Akron. Can they do it again? Keep us tuned into that one. Wow.
Very
complete here, Herbie.
Very surprised that while we talk a lot about Tyler Lockett, at this point, he has 9 receptions. He's the only receiver tonight to catch a football for Kansas State. They've thrown a ball to Hubert out of the backfield. But at this point, I mean, and Lockett's going to continue to make plays, but Jake Waters has got to find some other receivers and even a tight end to try to help him out. Lockett can't do it alone.
And they give him another shot. That's Thompson as they go to 86 this time. So they did go to the other wideout.
And Texas cheated their coverage where they had a corner up tight locked up against Lockett, and then they had a safety behind it. A very good decision by Jake Waters to go to the field. Much longer throw, but at least they pick up the first down, and a nice effort that time by Thompson to secure the football.
Only 3:23 left here in the third quarter. Here comes Hubert. Cut to daylight. Comes across midfield, battles his way for a few extra yards. Remember, his fumble turned into a Texas touchdown here in the second half.
Pretty good effort here by the right tackle, Rooks, getting up to the second level. He's a big man to get up there, over 300 pounds. But this is the second time we've seen Hubert. He loves to go to kind of laterally, create those vertical seams, and then he has that vision and experience of knowing when to hit it and accelerate upfield, and they pick up that first down.
14 more yards, 41 yards on the ground. Hubert stays in. There's big Gronkowski. Yes, he of the famous Gronkowski family. This one, one of the young'uns, Glenn. Rob, of course, the star with the Patriots. Fires it off complete to Lockett now. Speaking of the NFL, get your NFL Sunday Start on ESPN, 10 a.m. Eastern. NFL Countdown, Chris Berman of the gang provide all the latest news and updates from stadiums around the league. Among the stories, folks, you're not going to want to miss a Patriots fan with an incurable heart condition who met Tom Brady and spent the day with him. Then 11 a.m. on ESPN2, Fantasy Football. Get your team ready. Gave him Eifert last week, and then,
it was a good call by you.
Second down, you see.
The quarterback, second time in a row, he's seeing man coverage, one-on-one coverage, and he's trying to find the receiver. Last play, this time he's trying to run the football.
He's short of it. A second down below with Heather Cox.
Well, guys, Greg Robinson's new defense without one of its stars. Linebacker Jordan Hicks is in the locker room. You saw him get carted out. He has a left ankle injury. He will not return. Very frustrating for a guy, as Herbie mentioned, has been injury-prone, suffered a season-ending injury last year against Ole Miss, so now Texas without one starter on offense and one on defense, guys.
Two big time.
Yeah, those are big time players.
Yeah.
And there's a big third and one for that defense right now. Waters tried to pick it up himself. It's going to be close. Looks like it's going to be spotted short of our unofficial yellow line there. So with the score being what it is and where they are, this was four down territory at because of the down and distance for Coach Snyder.
And this is Bill Snyder's challenge when he's using the dual quarterbacks. Clearly, Sam's is suited for the last play and this play, but he's going with Waters because of his ability to throw the football, and he hopes that Waters can do just enough when it comes to running that part of their offense.
DJ Finney, and there was a crash across the line. I think they may have drawn Texas offside on this play. Let's see, Finney was applauding there.
Offside with contact, defense number 90. 5-yard penalty yields the first down.
And Malcolm Brown committed the contact.
You know, you wonder if they're just kind of guessing, trying to guess, because I don't think Waters was trying for a hard count. He almost started to pull himself out to make sure everybody was on the same page when Texas jumped.
You did not see Finney show any bluff or anything. This is going to bring up second down and long. B.J. Finney, the center, is such a great story. Father died a few years ago, walked on. Mother worked a couple of jobs to keep him in school. And finally, Bill Snyder called him into the office and said, "You have a full scholarship, young man." And here he is, last year, the all-Big 12 center. He said he would have had to transfer if he didn't get that scholarship. That's how short of funds he was. Just one of those wonderful stories in college football. Second down and nine now. Firing to the near side, incomplete. Lockett was going a little bit deeper and didn't break that route off.
Now, they weren't on the same page, but you could tell that he had what he wanted into the boundary, a shorter throw, one-on-one, and a chance to try to make a play against a corner in Evans, who hadn't played as much as some of the others. He had the matchup exactly what he wanted. He just wasn't quite on the same page and not in sync with Lockett. He's got him in the exact same spot again. This time they have a safety over the top, though, to try to protect the corner.
Last play of the quarter. Waters runs away from the pressure. Got the first down into the red zone. Across the 15-yard line as we've come to the end of the third quarter. But so far, Texas is winning not only the game, but also the turnover battle. Back after this message and a word from your local ABC stations. Welcome back to ESPN Saturday Night Football, presented by Windows. Where Texas and Mack Brown lead 24-7. Mack has lost five straight to Kansas State. Remember, he has one goal left for his Longhorns. Win the Big 12 championship. Can Mack pull that off? Won't be easy, but can he pull it off? He'll go to a BCS bowl, and he will prove a lot of doubters wrong. But remember, this is a tiny, tiny step he's trying to make here tonight. There's a whole minefield ahead of the embattled Longhorn coach. But here tonight, his team has stood up so far to a team that's dominated. But Jake Waters, who ran for 13 yards on 3rd and 9 to end the third quarter, is trying to get the Wildcats into the end zone. Option look. Pitch now to Hubert. Run out of bounds on that far side. Steve Edmond.
Great call against man coverage. And Jake Waters, even though he has a background of being a pocket quarterback, you can see how hard he's worked on the option game and getting comfortable with the footwork and the pitch relationship with Hubert. That time, Texas attacked him. He got the ball out of his hands quickly and gave Hubert a chance to get around the corner to pick up 5 yards.
Remember, Bill Snyder has abandoned the two quarterback system here. He's gone with Jake Waters. Second down and 6. Option to the boundary. Hubert, tough. Not much daylight there. And Jenkins, Peter Jenkins, number 19, reads it.
Well, we just talked about how he does a good job of the option. Here's the man he wants to option right here. He needs to attack him and take him out of the play. He didn't attack here. And by not attacking there, it allows the defender to make the play. Jenkins baited him and then used his speed to chase Hubert down.
And make that solo tackle. So here's your third down and 11. Inside shovel pass, Hubert. Got the first down. It is first and goal. A beautifully delivered shovel pass, Harvey.
Great time to call it, and a good block by Keenan Taylor, the right guard. A little shovel pass. I think it caught Texas off guard completely. They were looking at the receivers downfield. I think they lost sight of Hubert that time. And again, the right guard Taylor led the way around. It's a pretty good moves there by Hubert. Some good footwork to keep that play alive.
Goal line defense, first down and goal. Hubert, the running back. Battling touchdown. Kansas State stays alive early in the fourth quarter.
That was a huge drive for Kansas State. Check just to make sure that Hubert. Good surge by Kansas State. See if Hubert extends the ball. Yeah, clearly across and a touchdown for Bill Snyder. It's exactly what they needed here to start this fourth quarter.
That's Hubert's second touchdown of the night. And this would pull Kansas State after the extra point, if it's successful, to within 10. A lot of time remaining here in the fourth quarter.
Kansas State's goal when they play these teams for Big 12 powers with a lot of ability, get it to the fourth quarter, get it within one possession.
Cantelli tacks on the extra point. You're watching ESPN Saturday Night Football on ABC. Well, they're widely regarded as football's first family, so join us as we revisit the upbringing of the Manning brothers with never-before-seen footage, stories from their childhood all the way to their NFL startup. SEC Story, The Book of Manning, Tuesday at 8 p.m. Eastern on ESPN. Also live on Watch ESPN. For those of you who like this, I love the Giants in Carolina. I love a desperate Giant team. Eli Manning is better than he looked last week. Do that what you might with that. Here we go.
Oh. Here we go. Getting tips out.
Fielded at the 10 by Sanders. Swinging wide to the right. Blasted out of bounds at the 35-yard line. Well, Herbie, take a look at the Pacific Life game summary. Get everybody up to date.
Texas's defense heard all week how bad they've been in their last two ball games. They came out with an attitude. First four possessions, Kansas State couldn't do anything. They had four punts. Gave David Ash a chance to settle into this game. Hit a big play to Kendall Sanders for a touchdown to give Texas an early lead and kind of get David Ash going. And after that, he just handed the ball off to Jonathan Grant. Texas stepped out to a big lead 24-7. But Kansas State, all of a sudden, is pulled within 10 after that last drive to get it to 24-14.
Now, Case McCoy has replaced David Ash, being evaluated again for a concussion. Jonathan Gray is in as McCoy's running back, but he snaps it off incomplete. John Harris was the target that time.
That was a great throw by Case McCoy, and I love the call by Major Applewhite. Case McCoy is, for the most part, been just managing the game, handing the football off here on first and 10 after a touchdown. Get the ball out of his hands quickly. Accurate throw. Harris just dropped it. Back, right back to him.
And that will make it third down and one. And our play caller liked the daylight that time, Herbie, and he went right back.
And Roberts has been giving such a big cushion. Until he's willing to come up and take that away, if you need 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 yards with Roberts lined up deep and also bailing, might as well just take it.
Third and two.
Now they tighten up their coverage on third and short.
McCoy looks back to the left side, throws sideline, first down, Marcus Johnson.
I think Kansas State, if they want to come back into this game, they have to be willing to take some chances. This time, Kip Daly initially lined up tight right at the line of scrimmage, and then he bailed at the snap of the ball.
Here's Gray, his second down and 10, and that stopped by the middle. Reed was there, the young man. Well, actually, he's a senior from Wichita, so he's no longer a young man.
The reason that's important to try to challenge these Texas receivers, even though it's a bit of a risk, is because you can disrupt the timing with a backup quarterback, try to make him take a chance, and try to maybe force it into traffic. I think at this point in the game, you got to take those chances.
Malcolm Brown also in the game. He gets the handoff. This is going to be third and long. Clock winds down inside of 12. We've got a 10-point cushion here. And the Longhorns have not turned the ball over once here tonight. That remembers the big story of the recent history against Kansas State. Bergeron in as the back on third and 10 for Mack Brown. McCoy, far side, knocked away. Penalty flag, however. Roberts with the coverage that time on Harris. And there is a penalty flag.
Pass interference. Defense, number four. Automatic first down.
Dorian Roberts, penalty, Herbie.
Dorian Roberts, again there's that soft coverage. This time he's anticipating the throw. He does the right thing, but just got there way too early. His left arm all over Harris, and it gives Texas the first down.
Gray's the running back, going to sweep it to the left. Zimmerman up with a great tackle. Ty Zimmerman.
We love Ty Zimmerman, as you can tell in Brent's call. Two-time captain, his dad's his high school coach, came up in a hurry. And if he doesn't make that tackle, Brown gets around him and picks up maybe a first down.
There is Pop.
He's fired up after that play.
Drives to every game following his high school game. Doesn't miss a game. Second down and 11. Play action. McCoy. Boundary side, and a great grab that time. Marcus Johnson.
They picked on Kip Daly that time. It's a simple read for Case McCoy. If the defensive back stays up, you go over the top, and that's what he did. He sat on the underneath route.
Now they come back with Gray, the running back, for a couple of yards after that 21-yard completion. So Major Applewhite and Mac Brown did not sit on it. They went up on top. Mac wants another touchdown here, 10-26. He knows 10's not enough.
A Case McCoy feathering that in there, and an outstanding catch that time by Johnson. We've seen a couple that he's made on that far boundary where he's had to get his feet down and stretch out to make a play.
Bergeron. He's got the carry. Bounces outside. Broke one tackle and battles his way and picks up a little over a yard. Tough run.
I think that's why you have to swarm as a Kansas State defense. It took three defenders that time to slow him down.
Here's third and six coming up. And it looks like Malcolm Brown may have checked in from the sideline. There he is. So he's going to be the running back. Here's your third and six. Press. Here they come. Malcolm Brown tries to bounce outside. Zimmerman couldn't hold him up. Dives for the end zone. Touchdown. What a great run by the junior Malcolm Brown.
They blitzed the two linebackers up the middle, and Texas ran to the outside. There's the effort again by Ty Zimmerman to try to get a big play for this defense. And when he wasn't able to make the play, Kip Daly had no chance of taking on Marcus Johnson and also stopping Malcolm Brown from scoring.
Malcolm Brown did a great job of staying in the air until he broke the plane with that football. An instant replay, maybe taking another look at this, but I just thought it was a great effort by Brown.
The ruling on the field of a touchdown is under further review.
Here's a look we haven't seen. Knees are still up. Dives. Oh, it's close.
It sure is.
Touch.
With that helmet of Roberts in the way, you have a difficult time picking up exactly where the football was. Remember, it was third and six from the 9-yard line. So even if he doesn't get the touchdown, it's going to be a first and goal.
From what we've seen so far, it'd be hard to reverse this call on the field. And if he is down, it might be at the half-inch line. Talked about Jonathan Truman and Blake Slaughter, the two inside linebackers. See him right up the middle. They got picked up. And there's that vision from Brown bouncing it to the outside and the effort that you talked about, Brent, to try to get it into the end zone. Kansas State did roll the dice there by blitzing those backers. Remember, this is a Kansas State defense. It's breaking in six of seven new starters in that front seven. Three new starters in that secondary. This is their first time on the road.
After further review, the ball carrier's knee was down prior to the ball breaking the plane. It'll be Texas's ball, first and goal at the 1 foot line.
Wow. Like you said, if they rule it down, right at the wrong foot line. So it'll be right. First down and goal. And Malcolm Brown did such a great effort. You've got to give it back to him.
Give him the ball.
Let De La Torre lead the way.
I think everybody in this stadium and everybody watching at home knows who's about to get to football.
Here's your ISO look to the offset a little bit. It's a fullback to the right. Here it comes, cut away, bangs into the end zone. Still no signal, touchdown. Took an extra effort, but number 28, Malcolm Brown, got the job done.
Probably the greatest thing that you can say about Texas's performance tonight, with all the negativity that's been swirling around them, is these players still have some want. They still have some fight in them for this season, despite everything that they've been through, not just this year, but these last 3 or 4 years. I've been impressed by their determination and attitude they played with tonight.
A happy running back. And why not? 31-14, Texas.
Saturday Night Football presented by Windows. Brought to you by Windows. Chick-fil-A. We didn't invent the chicken, just the chicken sandwich. And Rush, from director Ron Howard, and based on the incredible true story, Rush, in theaters Friday.
Yeah, Bebo says eat a lot of that Chick-fil-A, gang. And a reminder to stay tuned, except on the West Coast, for your late local news over most of these ABC stations. Of course, SportsCenter on ESPN will have all the scores from a very, very busy day. Big show here for the Texas Longhorns. Herbie, you were making a point about the youngsters and the coaching staff.
I've just been really impressed. It's been a tough week. You know, on the outside, the local talk shows, the local columnists, you know, this morning, you know, on College Game Day, it's been going on all week. It's been going on since the BYU game. And you wondered what they might have left in them. Mac Brown talked about we still have the Big 12. We still can make a run and get to a BCS bowl game by winning the Big 12. And they're not going to celebrate that tonight, but I've just been impressed with the way they've come out and played as players tonight. They played with some heart. Much as people criticized it, lack thereof, they've shown some heart tonight.
Lockett runs up to the 5-yard line. To the 27-yard line. Well, you have to go back in time to the last time that the Longhorns were able to win. Chance Mock was the starting quarterback that night. Dale Roberson, great quarterback for Kansas State. But in the end, after he gave him the lead, it was Vince Young off the bench. And who does he search out after the winning touchdown? The man he replaced, Chance Mock. And that, folks, is the last time. Remember, the year they won the championship, the Longhorns, they did not play Kansas State. Well, the Big 12 was in divisions. You did not play every team in the other division. But it has been 5 straight wins coming into this game for the Wildcats. And that was a first down. And beginning to look like Jake Waters is going to be established as the Kansas State quarterback.
And I think as Kansas State goes in to the rest of their conference play, you know, as much as Bill Snyder wants to give both guys a chance, it does appear that Jake Waters, because he can throw the ball, if you don't, then people are just going to load up against Sam's in the running game. At least Waters can do just enough for the running game and the option attack.
First down and 10. Offensive line holds. Incomplete. Let's check in with Robert Flores for an update. Robert.
All right, Brent, Michigan has come back to tie this game after an interception. Fitz Toussaint goes in, and the Wolverines tied with UConn 21-21 in the fourth quarter.
Robert, go figure. That one we thought would be one-sided, and this one we thought would be close.
but that's why they play the games. And Texans leads this one 31-14. 8.5 minutes remaining for Kansas State. Second down and 10. And a wrestling match with the clock still running on that sideline. Thompson, the receiver.
I think that's what Texas wants to do right now. It's not just about trying to get Kansas State off the field. It's about securing victory, getting pressure on Waters, trying to keep the ball in bounds. These defensive backs have played pretty well for the most part tonight.
Third down and 5. First and 10 as he snaps it off to Curry Sexton. His first reception of the night. The young man from Abilene, Texas.
And a strong arm from Waters here. He's on the left hash. He throws this all the way to the numbers on a third down and short where the defensive backs are anticipating a shorter throw. He had to put a lot on that football, and he made a nice throw there to pick up the first down.
7.5 minutes remain. Waters going to go deep downfield, and play had stopped. So Duke Thomas picked it off, but it didn't matter because the play had been stopped.
Well, there is a lot that went on there. You had Mac Brown and Dwayne Aquina trying to call a timeout. You've got a flag down. Just what happened first? Dwayne Aquina and Mac Brown were going crazy trying to get a timeout called.
Prior to the snap, Texas called a timeout. However, by rule, personal fouls are still enforced. Personal foul, targeting, defense number 33.
He's kicked out.
15-yard penalty.
That's Steve Edmund.
And by rule, number 33 has disqualified himself from the game.
Now, this is the second half, and it would hurt Texas in their next game in the first half, but it goes upstairs to instant replay. They can overturn the ejection, but not the penalty. Watch the linebacker. He does come in high. Yeah. It does come in high. It's not necessarily helmet to helmet, but if they feel he targeted the quarterback, he's gone.
For people that have been confused by this rule, they've talked at times about the crown of the helmet. A defenseless player, in this case a quarterback, after he throws the ball, if he's hit above the shoulders, it's targeting. You can use your forearm, you can use your face mask, it doesn't matter what you use to hit a player. And the video that we just saw, it's targeting of a defenseless opponent without a doubt above the above the neck area, right in the head.
Let's talk about the reason for this rule. And let's remember tonight, David Ash was knocked out of the game in the first half. Certainly not a dirty play. I don't mean to indicate that. But because of a possible concussion, they are trying to limit the number of head injuries.
Targeting is under further review.
That's right. Now, remember, all instant replay can do is say he was not ejected from the game. They cannot overturn the penalty.
And the only way they can overturn this if the initial contact was somehow to the shoulder and then he went up to the headgear. But if the initial contact, the very first thing he hit, was above the neck, then they'll hold on to the call that's on the field and he'll be ejected. And the video that we've seen so far looks like he hit him above the neck.
So again, if Edmund is ejected from this game, he will have to sit out. Here we go.
After further review, the ruling on the field of targeting is confirmed. Number 33 is disqualified.
And he is out for the first half. And I believe Texas' next game is against Iowa State on a Thursday night. So he will be out on the road for the first half of that game. And this is what they're trying to eliminate in football.
And you have
we can't measure intent, but there's no question that was up
high. And you have to respect
when it's like that, you have to respect the rule and what they're trying to achieve here.
Absolutely. What they're trying to achieve is a key thing with this rule. It's too bad for the young man. And now it is first and 10 at the 32-yard line.
He was having a big night tonight. Steve Edmund, 11 tackles and a sack. It was a position that Greg Robinson and Mack Brown were really emphasizing improvement from the Ole Miss and the BYU game. And Steve Edmund came in prepared and played well, with the exception of that play right there.
You know, we have an official back in the studio in Bristol, Dave Kataya. He is our expert. He's a former Pac-10 coordinator of officiating. Dave, come on in here and tell us if we were correct, if you two thought that was targeting and the young man should be kicked out of the game.
Brett and Kirk, I think you're absolutely correct. All the elements are there. You've got to launch. The contact is clearly above the shoulders, and it's pretty clear that his helmet hit the helmet of the quarterback. And you also mentioned that that player's defenses. He absolutely is defenseless. So correct.
Well, regardless, we're playing again, and after the penalty, toward the end zone, caught by Lockett. What a great catch. Oh, baby, at the 1 yard line. Penalty flag on it, but Lockett looked to me like he was making a great catch here, Herbie.
It could have gone either way. Lockett has had a huge night, despite this game right now going in favor of Texas. Lockett looked like at the very end he may have pushed off of Diggs. And Diggs kind of landed on the ground and looked back at the official like, you know, he pushed me all over the back here to get open, to get separation, to make the catch. How about Lockett not only catching the football, but knowing where he is and extending himself to try to get to the goal line? Yeah, there was the initial hold early by Diggs.
Personal foul, hands to the face, defense number 99. Pass interference, defense number 6.
Offset.
They decline both of these, and they get the ball. They didn't give him the touchdown. They give him the ball. Yeah, all the way down. Well, look, here's the first, the hands to the face, right over the center. As a pass rush, he just gets right up into the face and the grill of Keenan Taylor. And Diggs was complaining because of the push-off at the end, but you can see early Diggs had a hold of his jersey, and then Lockett pushed at the end to separate to make the catch.
Still 7 minutes to go in this game, Herbie. And right straight ahead for the touchdown. So Jake Waters gives the Wildcats a life here. The crowd still upset about the ejection of the Mike linebacker, Steve Edmund.
And there's, as you said, still a lot of time left in this game. Texas better keep their eye on the prize right now.
Well, we want to thank Steve Kataya and Jace, I'm sorry, on that. The extra point is tacked on. A 10-point game, and still 7 minutes to go. Hang on, everybody. Well, we welcome you back to Austin, where all kinds of things have broken out here. Officially, we have 7 minutes remaining. The Longhorns up by 10. Linebacker has been ejected. Wildcats have scored. And now we're not sure that that should have been a completed pass when we looked at the replay. That's right. Tyler Lockett was going down, and it appeared in one of the replays, like the end of the football, struck the ground. But at any rate, it counts right now, and it's 31-21. Here's Sanders. He's down. So let's go back here, Herbie, and take another look at Lockett now. Watch the end of the football as it comes down.
Well, definitely looks like there was some contact, but it looked like maybe his right hand got underneath. So this is where they had two penalties on Texas that they declined. Looks like a catch to me.
Close.
Yeah. But nonetheless, six plays, 73 yards, a little over 2 minutes, which is exactly what Kansas State had to do to try to give himself a shot here. Now they got to get this Horns offense off the field if they want to get it within one possession.
Gray, the running back, breaks loose. And that is why Major Applewhite wanted him as the number one running back here tonight.
A well-designed play. This is just going to follow his block of the tight end. Swaim cuts it back. He's been doing this a lot. He's been bouncing it to the outside. This time he cuts it back, a design cut back. And I think this is almost a coming out party for Jonathan Gray. He played well last year. You talked about how Major Applewhite feels like he's emerged. Tonight we're seeing he's really asserting himself.
137-yard night, Harvey. Two touchdowns.
That's right.
Exactly. First down and 10. Applewhite goes to work on the clock. And what the Horns want to avoid here is any kind of a turnover. They lead it by 10.
They played smart football on this side of the field all night long. Whether it was David Ash in the first half, or boy, give Case McCoy a lot of credit for coming in relief. He's been 5 of 8. Hadn't thrown a lot of passes, but he's managed this game, getting into the right checks, showing that veteran attitude that he has.
Malcolm Brown is also there with Gray, alongside the quarterback, Case McCoy, who has come on here in the second half. Texas has not turned the ball over in this game. And here comes Gray. And let us check in with Robert Flores for an update.
All right, Brent, AT&T All-America Player of the Week nominee. How about the collection of running back for Wisconsin? In total, 45 carries, 375 yards, 5 touchdowns in their win against Purdue. You can text VOTE to 34763. And a week from tonight, Wisconsin will take on Ohio State. That will be the primetime game on ABC. Fellas?
And Robert, tell the Buckeye defenders to buckle up, everybody. Here come those Badger running backs. What else he's doing, huh, Herbie? 5 minutes to go now. McCoy puts it up. And Shipley goes down. Is there a penalty flag? The crowd certainly wanted it.
The only thing it could have been, if they're not going to call that, is incidental contact. But Shipley went down, and if he didn't go down, he probably makes his catch. Evans, boy, he hooks him with his left arm.
No question about the hook. Was it catchable here if he'd stayed up?
To me, it looks like that's a questionable call. Hooked him with his left arm.
There's no question he hooked him. So on fourth down now, Thompson is back deep, fair catch. At the 33-yard line, 4:49 to go. Wildcats with a football when you come back. NASCAR's chase to the Sprint Cup continues Sunday. New Hampshire points leader Matt Kenseth looks to build on his momentum, keep Kyle Busch and Jimmy Johnson from gaining ground. Don't miss the Sylvania 200 in New Hampshire tomorrow, 1 p.m. Eastern on ESPN.
Last time they had a ball, 6 plays, a little over 2 minutes, and a touchdown. Had some help from Texas with some penalties. A blitz right here.
It's Santos being forced into this game with Edmund out of it, number 55, who walked back complete on first down. Thompson out to the 40-yard line now.
Well, Jake Waters, as you know, with under 5 minutes to go now, 3 timeouts, 2-possession game. He's got to get these guys. He's got to have some urgency, more urgency than what we're seeing right now.
Sexton is lined up to the boundary side. Andre McDonald is the big tight end, but they've got to move.
Yeah,
they're wasting many, many precious seconds here. Jeff Coat gets to Jake Waters with his pops in the stands.
His dad, a great, great defensive end in the National Football League for years.
He went up against a tight end and Andre McDonough. And I'll tell you the thing that Jeff Coat has developed.
There's Pops.
There's his dad.
Hey,
the big fella.
That's my son.
Back in the glory
years. How'd you like to try to block Pops even today?
Well, I was going to say, he has developed his dad's power. He used to have just quickness. Now he has that power from his dad.
Dallas Cowboy fans remember Jim Jeffcoat very, very well. Yeah. Third down and seven now. Going to go deep down that far side. Lockett's got it in stride and out of bounds. What a night for Tyler Lockett.
That's his 13th catch, 237 yards. And the one thing you cannot do when you're up big is get beat deep. Especially in this situation, one-on-one coverage. Waters has shown an ability to lock, put the ball, the deep ball, right over the shoulder of Lockett. It's the third time we've seen it tonight.
52 yards on that pass play. Jake Waters has thrown for 275 now. Remember, they're down to 3 minutes, and they need two scores. They can't sit on one. Option boundary. Hubert cut off. Santos was over there to help cut him off, and Jenkins. So the two linebackers got to that option look, and there is Lockett in stride, Herbie.
It's the one thing you can't do. And Greg Robinson, in his defense, he's been here for just a couple weeks trying to get this thing figured out, streamlining some of their disguising and what they're doing defensively. That time, the next play on the option, great play by Santos to keep the running back in bounds and keep the clock moving.
Remember, he replaced Edmund, who was ejected from the game. Number 55.
They're using the entire play clock. Look at this.
End zone, incomplete. And a penalty flag is called on Texas Phillips. Horns are arguing that it was uncatchable. That's going to be a first down, but what's critical at this point, the clock.
Prior to the pass, holding defense number 17. Had the distance to the goal, automatic first down.
So the safety was holding.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. He's doing anything he can to slow down Lockett in the night that he's had. Remember the quarterback got hit earlier by Edmund? This time, his backup Santos makes sure he goes low when he hits this quarterback, not to come anywhere close to hitting a defenseless player high.
A learning lesson.
That's right.
First down and goal. K-State needs two scores. Winding down toward 2 minutes. Waters keeps it, sneaks ahead. Fumble! Battle for the ball. It may be Horn's football. The scrum breaks out. And Texas comes away with a loose ball. Dalton Santos, the young man who replaced Edmund.
Now, there was a seam and there was a crease for him to be able to try to slip through. It's not his strong suit. This is something that Waters doesn't always do. He just ran to the backside of Whitehair, and the ball came out. I mean, they were getting a push.
Well, remember, Herbie told you at the top of the night that Kansas State had won the battle of turnovers against Texas in this five-game winning streak. Not here tonight. And look at Greg Robinson. Look at the new defensive coordinator. 62 years young. He's back in business. There's their turnover margin of a year ago. Herbie also told you how many guys up front they've lost.
Yeah. It's a team that is undermanned. They've got to come together and play on the road and have every break go their way, and that's not been the case tonight.
And we welcome you back to Austin, Texas. The Longhorn. The Longhorns desperate for a win. Lead Kansas State 31-21. It has been an eventful night down here in Austin for those of you who just joined us. Mack Brown, under enormous public pressure, has said the last goal on the table is to win the Big 12 championship. His starting quarterback, David Ash, returned in the first half, was knocked out with another possible concussion, having missed the Mississippi game a week ago. Case McCoy is under center right now, and he has Jonathan Gray as his running back. And Irby, tell the folks who joined us what kind of a night the Horns have had, especially Jonathan Gray.
Well, they've been backed into a corner, and they came out tonight, and they fought. You know, they really have. Kansas State just blew an opportunity. Their quarterback, Jake Waters, fumbled at the 3-yard line. They were trying to go in to try to get this to a 31-28 game. Texas got the fumble and got the football back here late in this football game, or it could have been a very interesting finish.
So we're going to take you back, and we're going to get those of you up to date. This was the handoff to Malcolm Brown, who barged across for the touchdown. Now, this is what Herbie told you about. He's going to run up the backside of his guard, lose the football, and a backup linebacker, Dalton Santos, recovers, and he replaced Steve Edmund, who was kicked out of the game for targeting. And there is their new defensive coordinator, Greg Robinson's reaction. Those of you who are watching us in Syracuse and Ann Arbor are probably saying, we never saw Greg celebrate like that when he was with us.
No.
But it is such a nice story. Greg Robinson has come back. He was once a defensive coordinator. He has changed up things, and Herbie, they've allowed only 399 yards here tonight.
And this is a defense that two games ago gave up 550 yards on the ground alone to BYU and 272 yards on the ground to Ole Miss last time out.
And a handoff to the go-to back. Gray has rushed 26 times for 138 yards here tonight. And the two quarterbacks, David Ash again, played only the first half.
Yeah, he missed last week because of the concussion in the BYU game. He came out, played very, very well in an up-tempo style of offense. He did get dinged, so they held him out at halftime to start the second half, and Case McCoy has stepped in. Hadn't had to do a lot, but he's managed the game very nicely for Texas.
Irby, this is one step, though, for Mac Brown. It's not over. The quest to win the Big 12. And here is the schedule. On a Thursday night, they will play Iowa State on October 3rd. Then the big one in Dallas, the Red River rivalry. Can Mac snap that 2-year beating that he's taken at the hands of Oklahoma? Then they've got to go to TCU. You got Kansas. Kansas won a big game today. West Virginia down a little bit, but Oklahoma State and Baylor, two of your last.
Honestly,
Texas Tech.
Outside of Kansas and West Virginia, there isn't any game on their schedule that's necessarily a gimme. On a Thursday night to go to Ames, Iowa, ask Oklahoma State how much fun that is from a few years ago with Justin Blackman and Brandon Whedon, and they couldn't get out of there.
So the Wolves are howling at the door. But here tonight, the Longhorns regrouped and turned in by far their most impressive performance of the season. And this will move them to 2-2. And coming up after the game, stay tuned for the Ford wrap-up with Robert Flores.
And I think it needs to be said that Mac Brown's taken a lot of criticism, not just this week, not just since the BYU game, but really the last 4 years. In 09, they're in the national championship against Alabama. The last 4 years have not gone the way he would like or their fan base would like, and people have already been talking about. There was a report this week, remember, that Nick Saban's been contacted. Is Nick Saban going to be the next coach? They're trying to replace him before they even have let him go. He's heard all that. He blocks it out. He's focused his team on getting him ready for tonight. And you got to give him a lot of credit because his team's played with a lot of heart.
Then you can forget that Nick Saban gossip.
Of course.
Here is Farrah from the end zone. And this is Thompson. Picks it up. And he's got an alley. Give him a couple of blocks. And he'll head for the end zone. And he is finally stopped near the 10-yard line with 1:26 to go.
Thompson and this Kansas State team just not going to give up on this. Looked like a little push in the back there by Zimmerman. They get away with another push in the back there by Hubert. And then he gets an alley. That's definitely a push in the back. That wasn't Hubert. That was Morgan Burns, who also wears 33. And then he gets a convoy down the left sideline.
It's a 40-yard return with 1:26 to go.
Let's go, D!
quick strike, well, onside kick, and who knows?
Yeah, and without any timeouts, you need to take some shots into the end zone so you avoid either getting sacked or not, or coming up a little bit short of the end zone and letting the clock continue.
Mack was pointing at one of the replay boards, and he detected that push that Herbie told you about. That's the reaction of the crowd, juggled by Lockett a little bit high. So it'll be second down and 10. Phillips, the safety for the Longhorns right there.
And if people are just tuning in, Waters has looked to his man Lockett, Tyler Lockett, all night long. The ball's a little bit high. Lockett tonight, 13 catches tonight alone. He's been isolated in man-to-man coverage. He had 237 yards receiving tonight. And you got to think they're going to find ways to try to get him the football down here in Deacon, Texas territory.
Second down and 10. Now Waters got sacked by Jeff Coat again. Jackson Jeff Coat, and there's his daddy, an assistant coach with Colorado. He is here tonight.
And remember, they're out of timeouts. The last thing that Bill Snyder wanted to see was a sack. This tight end, Andre McDonald, held again against Jeff Coat. He cannot handle that pass rush. They need to help him with a running back.
On third and 18. Jeff Coat trying to get there, but his play is stopped.
Full start. Offense, number 86. That's a 5-yard penalty. It's third down. By rule, the clock was running under 1 minute. This requires a 10-second runoff. Game clock operator, please set the clock to 37 seconds. The clock will start on the ready for play.
That's the worst part of the penalty.
Absolutely.
Running the 10 seconds off. Jeff Coat has 2 sacks in the last 2 series that Kansas State's had, and they both come up against a tight end, Andre McDonald, where he's gone right around him.
Now he's matched against Cornelius Lucas. Fumble, loose ball. Texas is going to win its opener in the Big 12. They will snap the 5-game losing streak at the hands of Kansas State. Mack Brown with a little breathing room.
This program and this team really coming alive. That ball is out before his hand is coming forward. This time it's on the other side with Cedric Reed. We've seen Jeff Coat. This time it's Reed. And look at Mack Brown, the relief. The relief for Mack Brown. He's going to be able to secure a victory with Kansas State out of timeouts.
A little Texas pride tonight here in Austin. Give these youngsters a whole lot of credit, not to mention the coaching staff. They didn't get down on themselves. And Kansas State will bounce back from this, trust me. That's an outstanding coaching staff over there. Bill Snyder knew he was going to get a big shot tonight from Mack Brown and the Longhorns. And we asked Mack Brown about all the players that Bill Snyder lost. He said, Bill Snyder didn't graduate. They're okay at Kansas State. And that is the truth.
No doubt about it.
Something to cheer about in Austin, Texas tonight. Against a replay, wants to check with our referee as we take another look at this.
It's all about if the ball is still in his hand as his arm is coming forward. The ball is out.
And thankfully, the National Football League changed that horrendous tuck rule. There is no question that is a fumble.
Are you not a fan of that, that particular night or just in general?
In general.
Sure?
In general.
Okay.
No, the Patriots winning that night against the Oakland Raiders. It's okay.
It was okay.
It was okay. I could still buy breakfast.
Okay.
It was okay.
Just making sure.
I don't know, because you had some conviction there.
I thought it was a lasting memory.
Mm.
After further review, the ruling on the field that the quarterback had an empty hand has been confirmed. First and 10, Texas.
This crew's had their hands full tonight, but for the most part,
I think they've done a good job.
They've done a pretty good job.
Yeah, referee is Reggie Smith again. And then, of course, Walt Coleman, who for a long, long time has been outstanding AFL referee. He kind of oversees the officials in this conference, and he does a terrific job. No, I thought the crew did an outstanding. Tough game. Tough game to officiate.
Sure was. Can't say it enough. Mac Brown, circle the wagons.
There's DeLoss Dodge, his athletic director.
He's been in there with him.
Always been behind Mac.
Yep.
He'll go see his good friend Bill Snyder now. There they are. A few words from Bill Snyder. No one's going to read his lips what he said to Coach. Great respect for each other.
It's an example of why in the coaching fraternity a lot of the guys pull for Mac Brown.
Well, they pull for each other.
Yeah.
They know how
tough
the job is. What have you done for me lately?
Absolutely.
You know, that's the world we're in, and I understand that. And so does every coach. And so do you. I mean, everybody understands it. That's just the way it is. Mac's done great. Made a lot of money down here. He's been very successful. He's done a wonderful job with Texas, and the heat's on. Tyler Lockett did a great job. And, of course, the big story of the night for me is the fact that David Ash is out again with another possible concussion. And dancing time here now in the state capitol. And family, Kansas State, goes off together as they enter together. Let's go down now to Heather Cox.
Brent, thanks so much. Coach, congratulations on the win. How does a win like tonight help change the perception of where this program is?
I think it's got a lot of eyes on it tonight, and the guys played hard. Defense played much better. We did more like we wanted to do on offense. We had every bit of adversity tonight we've had throughout the year so far and stepped up and handled it anyway. So I'm really proud of these guys and the coaches.
You told me flat out that this group of players hasn't played anywhere near where they're capable of these last 2 weeks. So what sparked that dramatic turnaround tonight?
Oh, I think they just weren't happy with who they were the last 2 weeks. That's not what we were in preseason. It's not what we were in the spring and not what we were planning on. So 1-0 in the Big 12 and moving forward.
Describe the sense of pride, Mac, that you feel for this group of men around you.
I really feel a lot of pride for these players especially, but the assistant coaches too. They've worked so hard to make tonight happen. And against a really well-coached, good football team in Kansas State, who we have not done very well against.
Right. And describe the conversation that you had with your quarterback, Case McCoy, in the locker room at halftime when you found out that you wouldn't have David Ash for the second half.
Well, we just told him, this is your turn. Mm-hmm. Last week was tough second half. Let's make this one a lot better. And he did.
Coach, enjoy the win. Speaking of Case McCoy, Case, congratulations on the win. Coach just talked about the conversation that he had with you, but tell me what your reaction was in the locker room when you found out that you'd be the go-to guy in the second half.
Yeah. First off, man, we're just praying for David. I mean, the head injuries are serious deals, and we don't take those lightly. So first off, praying for him, big guy on this team. We all love him to death, but you know, I got the word, ran out early, got warm. And had to roll, but you know, hats off. I really didn't do much. I handed the ball off to Jonathan and those backs and Malcolm, and you know, they made plays all night. Made a couple third down throws, but other than that, you know, this team finally is coming together. These are games that matter. These conference games, and hats off to our team, our coaching staff. I don't care who doubts us. This team's going to fight in and out week after week. And we're going to see what happens at the end of the season.
Your talk about this team coming together. Describe the team this week and how it changed tonight. The mood, the emotion of this group.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's amazing, our crowd. Our our crowd, you know, we've had some bad games. We haven't finished, and they're still showing up. They're a loud, big impact right there at the end of the game. But, you know, this team that fights. This team has always fought. And I think I've said that for 4 years now. It's not anything I've ever questioned. But, you know, the last couple weeks we didn't think we fought at the end of the game. And that was something that didn't matter what happened tonight. We were going to fight, and we're going to come through. And, you know, the score can tell the end if you fight.
What did it mean to get this win, not only for this team, but for your coach?
That's awesome. You know, we love Coach Brown. He recruited me. I've known him since I was a young guy. But, you know, thank the Lord I'm able to play this game that I love and have a passion for. And, you know, we're ready to move on. We got a week to get ready, get healthy, and then we move on to another big game. So we're excited where this team's going.
Case, thanks so much. Congratulations.
And thank you, Heather. A sweet sound in Austin. The eyes of Texas. Sounds a lot better than the boos they heard last week against Mississippi. The Horns win it 31-21. Join us next Saturday night at 8 p.m. Eastern on ABC as Wisconsin takes on Ohio State. Now it is time for the Ford wrap-up. So let's go to Robert Flores. Take it away, Robert.